Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to episode 130 of the Terminus Podcast. This is for the weeks of October 19th, 2019. I am your dispatcher, Ellis, otherwise known as the Admiral. With me, my engineers are Brett Wiebold and Nick Christensen, and our fireman is Jared Cole. Joining us as our brakeman...
He's dead.
Yeah, he's dead. Oh, well. Joining us as our guest brakeman for the first time is A Hat Bears, or A Hat Bears.
Hello, YouTube. What's up?
And also, if you said you have your own channel, so we could link yours if you want us to. Huge, massive following that would love to be. But, you know, if we get, like, one person to watch the show, that'd be, you know, that'd be an improvement. So, before
We have to specify that it's not against their will.
That's right, sorry.
Then it's an improvement.
Disclaimer.
Right. Well, before the people that we've tied up and forced to witness this podcast get too bored, the train will terminate at this station.
Okay, this week we are in Garry's Mod. We're going to be following Dean, the magic lamp, into the realm of Garry's Mod, specifically Union City, the day variant, for those curious.
We're not actually in yet. We're staring at the load screen, but we'll get there someday.
Well, then we're staring at a load screen.
Well,
the day variant,
don't
for
get,
those curious.
You know, the day variant of the load screen.
Precisely. The other one's just black.
Dark.
By the way,
the screen goes black and the computer gets thrown to death.
What game are you playing right now? Just asking out of curiosity.
Well, we're watching him play Garry's Mod.
I see.
Nobody else should be playing a game because that's against the rules. But
I see.
What isn't against the rules is derailing and letting us make a segment on it. And BNSF and NS followed that rule very thoroughly in the past couple of weeks. BNSF
now that you mentioned it.
What?
Now that you mention it, I'm not actually sure that derailing is specifically outlined as something you shouldn't do in the rule book. I'm not sure that derailing is against the rules.
It's not against our rules.
I mean, it's probably best to not tell your customers that, at any rate.
It kind of goes without saying.
Our rules.
I think I found a name for the podcast. anyway, BNSF started us off on October 7th, with a derailment between Keene and Tehachapi.
Oh, and they, dang it, I know right
they
where that's at.
Bunched up some covered hopper cars. I'm not sure if they're full or empty, but they look like they're empty based on the way they bunched up, and the fact that there isn't corn spilled everywhere. However, the incident tore up about a quarter mile of track, so maybe they were full. That's a lot of track.
yeah.
Maybe the cars were just very heavy.
10 rail cars. I mean, 10 cars tore up a quarter mile of track? They must have kept going with them or something.
Yeah, I was going to say, if it derails and nobody realizes it.
Yeah, 10 rail cars, 3 p.m. Monday, tying up tracks in both directions. Yikes. The following day, Norfolk Southern had its first derailment of the two-week period of the fortnight, I guess.
Oh, dang, really?
Butler County, Ohio, train collision causing 3 rear cars to derail. So we had a couple of collisions this week. This was the first of...
Hang on, let me mute. Sorry.
Okay. The collision took place around 1:33 a.m. Train heading southbound collided into the rear of another train, derailing 3 cars, 2 crew members taken to the hospital for examination. 3 rear cars were carrying 1 load of pulpwood and 2 loads of butane. So
2 units of butane.
So we had a nice possibility for a nice fat fire there, but no leaks, no fires, nothing fun, unfortunately. Fairfield City
collided with a train hauling matchsticks and propane.
Despite the fact that one of the trains in the video of the news report I'm watching appears to be a stack train.
Well, that was probably the one that ran into the back of the other one. The train is blocking the rail crossing on North Gilmore Road. Not that anybody here cares, but the Fairfield City Schools run a 2-hour delay. No morning kindergarten, no morning preschool, or morning Fairfield Academy. So
the kids love Union Pacific, right?
Yes.
NS.
Norfolk Southern right now.
They
Norfolk Southern, what What's your function?
If I recall correctly, this
on the new generation of rail fans.
This actually blocked all of the closed until Tuesday evening, so it took them a while to get that cleared. Let's see, what was the next one? A few days later, Norfolk Southern did it again. This was NS train derailed and struck a gas line.
That's not good.
Yeah, and this was a bunch of auto racks, which I assume are empty again based on the way that they tumbled everywhere. Because if not, boy, that was expensive. That's a lot of auto racks.
Thank God
the derailed
no one was
cars
injured.
Struck and ruptured a high pressure gas line. Feeding Great. A nearby Purdue Farms plant employees were kept in the building while the pipeline was shut down and the gas leak dissipated. No hazardous.
So
wait, what?
In the enormous accident where there's sparks and everything going over there, they tear open a gas line, and there isn't an enormous fire.
No, there was no fireball. There was no fire.
Wow.
So NS,
fantastic.
NS thus far this week, within the span of 4 days, crashed butane tankers and didn't explode them, and ruptured a gas line and didn't blow
it up.
So
somebody go and buy a lotto ticket.
Yeah, exactly.
No, go buy
or some new butane tankers because those are probably more useful.
Yeah. City of Dearborn. Okay, so hold on. The next one was CSX. 2 days following.
Speak of crash, smash, explode.
Yeah.
Surprise, surprise. The blue crashes again.
But we can't compare these two, because now CSX has crashed one time, and
hang on, I gotta get sorry about that.
NS has crashed four in the same span. So,
yikes.
The formerly safe ones are the ones making wrecks these days, I guess. Except for KCS. KCS will still continue on. KCS at some point is going to cease to be a class one, and then we're gonna have a way more interesting segment. So.
It won't be long till Ferromex takes over their Mexican operations.
See. 9 p.m., crash in a yard. One of the cars supposedly had some sort of hazardous material in it, but no explosions or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty low
speed
collision.
Not even risk of a flabby?
Cyanide is an explosive.
The next day, BNSF collided two trains east of Alliance.
Oh, no.
One of the trains
Nebraska?
Was stopped as another train hit the other in the rear while slowing down to stop. Both came off the tracks. It was two empty coal trains, and yeah, they made kind of a mess, but nobody was injured.
My question is, how did that Beth Gone Hopper actually end up on top of the locomotive?
Because it's empty.
G-Bot.
Yes, it was empty. I don't know. Speaking of G-Bot
physics, velocity is squared.
Did you guys see the video?
Because this is apparently super rated, it turns out.
Hold on, what was that?
Did you guys see the video of that gondola that was bouncing her all around all over the place?
I think I know the one you're talking about.
And it was
the one where it was hunting?
Yeah. Yikes.
And the last two photos, I just have so many questions about.
Oh, man. Well, stuff gets messy in train wrecks. Anyway, there was another derailment for BNSF east of Flagstaff reported with no injuries. This was on the 15th.
Stagflaff.
Nothing. I mean, the big takeaway from this is that they stopped up the Southwest Chief completely in both directions, and they had to bus people.
You know, that's the problem with the Southwest Chief. It never runs on time. I say we cut their funding immediately. Let's get rid of the Southwest. Burn the Southwest Chief.
You know what's ironic? How did that report card Amtrak came out with for on-time service? I wonder how BNSF didn't get an F, but Norfolk Southern did.
Because things were different then.
And it's also ironic when you know the Southwest Chief originated from the Santa Fe, one of the railroads that made up the BNSF. Sorry about that.
So, the following day, Norfolk Southern had their penultimate wreck of the period, which was four cars derailed in Millen, 7 p.m. Thursday.
Oh, no.
Carrying,
this makes four for NS?
There are a total of four. Also, they were carrying scrap paper, Toyotas, polyethylene, and mash.
What is a scrap papper Toyota?
It was four things. Four cars and four things. Polyethylene, Toyotas, scrap papper, and MASH.
Okay. Follow-up questions then. If it's not a Toyota, I know what a Toyota is. What is scrap paper and what is MASH?
Yeah, what the hell is
potatoes?
MASH?
I don't know.
Well, that's what it was. It was just a train full of potatoes, and then when it crashed, it became MASH.
It's like the potato truck that got one into, but a train.
It became MASH.
Potatoes anymore?
You telescope a boxcar of potatoes through a tanker of mayonnaise and make just mashed potatoes.
Yep. Mixed freight derailment. Okay, nothing super special there.
Stop it. You're gonna give me a heart attack.
The final wreck. See, we are funny sometimes. The final wreck was another NS wreck. This time it looks like one or two cars. One is tipped like at a 45-degree angle. I don't know how it's staying like that. The other one looks to have made an entire rotation off the tracks, you know, rolled off the embankment into the field and spilled plastic pellets all over the place. So
did it land right side up?
Nope.
Oh.
It more than rolled over. It would have been really neat if it landed right side up. That'd be kind of funny.
For the record, this isn't the first wreck I've heard of that involved plastic pellets. You remember the 1996 Cajon Pass runaway?
I mean, yeah. Lots of wrecks involve plastic pellets. They're just annoying to clean up.
And they're incredibly flammable.
Yep.
Well, there are
when
worse
saturated
things.
With diesel. That's true. Like butane.
Right. The butane didn't blow up, but the train full of plastic pellets. Kabam!
Woof.
Yeah.
Kabam! Loaded with coffee creamer and matchsticks.
Anyway, so those are the wrecks. That's the Class 1 mantle of responsibility. Kansas City Southern still holds it, of course, because of course they do.
Who?
Who? The links to all of those are going to be down in the cargos for anybody interested. And now we shall carry on.
I have the Class 4 mantle of responsibility, actually.
Yeah.
What is that?
The Rio Grande Southern had a derailment in Ridgeway over the past couple of weeks.
Oh, no.
And there's also, what class would Strasburg be considered?
-5.
3?
I don't know.
They'd be 3.
They're technically a common carrier, so it's 3.
Yeah, class 3, where Strasburg, where 611 derailed on Strasburg's track.
No, everything's fine over there. All right, I need to write the title down. Let's talk about what we've done in the past couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Well, that's what I was talking about.
What did you do?
The Colorado Railroad Museum recently shipped Goose 6, one of our three RGS motors, off to Ridgeway for a sort of mini Goose Fest. It was a reunion of the motors at their newly completed half-mile circle of track, because for whatever reason, three-foot gauge and half-mile circles just really, really... It's like,
but whose is actually bigger?
Of the loops?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I know Knott's Berry Farm beats the museum slightly. I don't know who out of the museum or Ridgeway wins. I'll have to find that out.
We need data. Yeah. We need numbers on this.
Data. I'll look into that after this. But anyway, Goose 6 got there. We sent a small crew, including croup? Crew.
Crew,
including our CMO. A coup, yeah. It was almost a coup because of the amount of RGS moments that happened. Goose 1 or Motor 1 broke an axle, the Model T kept overheating, and Goose 6 went backwards over a stub switch that wasn't aligned correctly and derailed. Twice.
Ooh.
It wouldn't be the CNS without it.
RGS.
RGS, sorry.
The people that derail and then explode.
Okay, got it. The people that keep excellent records, except for that one boiler that we won't talk about.
That's fine. It's probably steel.
Probably
steel. We need to talk about that.
61.
Oh, in the later section, I just thought of another piece of news.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Okay, we'll write it down so we don't forget.
I'm getting the link for it.
All right, well, I came back to Tolbrand with a vengeance. I had taken a week off for trips and sickness and all sorts of stuff like that. But I actually just completed an episode yesterday, and I am trying to force through the last big sections of area that I need to do and decide what the gray grid that I have left is gonna become. I spent 2 hours working on the town of Lionhead, which was actually a lot of fun, and I had a bunch of people on the show for it.
That was fun.
Yeah, and that's like the last...
I enjoyed that a lot.
It was really fun, and it's one of the last town sort of things I have to do for this section of Tolbrin. So I'm excited to get... I was excited to get that done, not just for that, but also because it's coming out to be a really neat little area. And I've been trying to parade trees up the grade so that we get the stuff done. Other than that, I mean, I went to the PN and I wanted to get stuff done. Well, what am I? Okay, just put it down.
No, just put it. What was that?
That'd be mad. Thank
you. Well,
wait, take this. Make trade. Sorry.
Bad trade.
Anyway, I was trying to say that I went there to work on some electrical stuff, and the electrical guy who has all the equipment didn't show up. So instead I got into an animated discussion about politics, as typically happens at the Model Railroad Club, and boy, is that fun. But
of course.
It did end with one of the guys who I... Thank you. One of the guys who I typically don't, you know, align with very much, although I'll say there are quite a spectrum of people that go to the Model Railroad. He, at the end, was like, you need to get into this stuff. You have heart. You've got a lot of, you know. And it meant a lot.
He's got chutzpah.
It meant a lot to me, coming from somebody who I basically agreed with on nothing that we discussed. To be telling me that I should get into politics, because they thought I would be good at it. So, you know. Although, I guess from some people that would be an insult. You'd make a great politician.
It's like you've got a face for radio.
So, we also got dates for the reunion of Victoria and Iron Horses, finally. But that we can talk about a little bit in the news section. Anyway, so what else have you guys been doing?
Well,
the horse from Loud.
I got 2019.
Yes!
I got 2019, and I spent this weekend moving over all my payware because that's what I wanted to do. And then, because I'm still planning on what I want to build, I'm still thinking about what I'm going to build. I'm getting ideas.
I've got lots of old maps if you want to take inspiration from them, stuff that people asked me for and then started and never finished. No, I don't take it personally.
I'm going to be honest about 2019. I have actually installed, I've briefly installed it a few times, and I honestly found it a bit weird how it comes with jointed rail payware.
It's normal.
The CSX, it contains jointed rail CSX GP40, D-2, A-2, the CNSG40, the CNC40-8.
Yeah.
I mean, JR and N3V are really close these days.
Yeah.
That's I'm true. Actually super happy about them putting all that stuff on the download station.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that means then we can even use that stuff for multiplayer. And...
Mm-hmm. For the record, I have gotten some the payware items I've gotten via my gold membership. Most of them have been jointed rail items.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't mean to say this, but frankly, a lot of the jointed rail payware is of better quality than a lot of the N3B payware.
That's not,
Can't deny that.
You're not wrong.
But
can't wait for jointed rail to release their Norfolk Southern AC, Norfolk Southern DC to AC conversions.
I've seen one of those. Chris was hiding in a bush, but I saw it.
Nice.
Yeah. I've been seeing the screenshots you've been posting.
Oh, that's right. That's right. I did not catch what you were talking about.
Yeah, we saw the shadow bonnet.
Yeah, I thought you were talking about something at the most recent stress report. Like, Chris is hiding in a bush. Oh, Chris is hiding in a bush. Right.
Yeah. No,
Chris
there
is a criminal, so he's hiding in a bush.
There hasn't been a second instance of Chris hiding in a bush.
Really?
Not lately. Disappointing. Not to my knowledge.
Here's an image of what I was just talking about.
It's tedious.
Dude. What's tedious?
Moving everything.
Oh, it's super tedious.
Agreed.
I went over my three rules of content transfer on the most recent under construction.
I heard.
It's also harder when you know you can't download all your files at once in Trains 2019 like you can do in earlier versions.
I wish you could just click and drag. That would be pretty cool.
Yeah. The thing is, it's not like... It seems like every time the file systems are incompatible. Like, Trains saves things differently across different versions. It's really weird, but it makes it so that if you move the stuff over, like, manually, without exporting it to CDP first, Trains just doesn't recognize it. It doesn't even know it's there.
Yeah.
That is weird.
It is weird.
By the way, out of curiosity, going back to the whole topic of the Norfolk and Southern Shadow Bonnets, how do we differentiate each one? Like, there's one that actually looks much like Shadow, and there's one with a blue outline.
Well, that's the Sonic.
Well, you got Sonic.
No, he's saying there's more than one black one. And I didn't know there were more than one black one until I saw this picture.
Are there?
Yeah, look.
Which one did we see?
I don't know.
Hang on, let me get the picture.
I have a picture of it somewhere. Oh,
Pennsylvania special trip.
I know, maybe the middle one could be the Seahawks. Oh,
sorry.
We saw the, like, red one.
Oh, you mean the Knuckles bonnet?
Mm-mm. No, like, the actual, it's black with red fringe.
Yeah.
Ah, well, that's, the shadow bonnet.
Yeah. But there's more than one shadow bonnet.
Yeah, well, there's one with
the
red.
This is the true one.
Sorry about that.
Okay.
Basically, a cold one came in and it's giving me a phlegm buildup.
Yeah, that happens. Oh. By the way, I've been working on Nine Horsemen. We bringing it up to date and finishing it.
Yep.
And so far, I've only got a few areas. Yeah.
Don't say such things. What?
I don't know when it'll be done, but it'll probably be done on Tuesday.
Soon, TM.
Yeah.
Moist.
To use the Dan Markoff quote there.
Hey, Weibold, how's 20?
So, 20 is fighting us, and 20 is a pain in the ass, but 20 is about to be put on the back burner until the end of the year because Polar is in 2 weeks.
Oh, yeah.
Bum, bum, bum.
Polar? You mean the Polar Express?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Let me guess. The Rango and Silverton Polar Express?
Nope.
Which one would it be?
Our Polar Express at the Colorado Railroad Museum. Buy your tickets now. I think they're still on sale. Oh, I want to kill
I don't live in Colorado.
Anyway, so that is fast approaching, and none of us are looking forward to it.
I'm sure a bunch of kids are.
Yeah, I mean, and that's really what makes it worth it, is that the kids enjoy it.
Anyone who grew up with the movie would enjoy it, too.
Like, I grew up with the movie. I don't. I ceased to enjoy it after, like, half of one event.
I'm going to go there and ride it and just try to be the most annoying kid.
That's, like, the plus for Polar, is with all the negatives that Polar has, it's one of the only events that we don't have to deal with the public, like, at all.
Why do you not have to? Wait a minute. Oh, because you've got, elves to do it?
Well, yeah, we've got the cooks and the elves, and we're not on the train. We're, like, in the engine, and we can close the cab curtains and literally just be sealed in the cab all night. The only thing we have to do is wave. That's it.
It's kind of funny to me how, even though I still like the Polar Express movie, it's funny to me how so many companies just do what they do with Day Out with Thomas's and just do Polar Express trains, despite the fact the movie only has 56% on Rotten Tomatoes.
I mean, Rotten Tomatoes is not a great indicator.
Also, everybody loves to ride the thing.
Yeah, fair point.
I love the movie.
I like the movie, too. I watch it every year. My childhood.
Yeah, but we're all foamers.
I used to watch it every year. No, I live it every year for 2 months out of the year.
I like how we're
at this point in my life, roughly 1/6 of my existence is Polar Express.
Wonder how many times I watched it? So many, it's burned the Warner Home video logo into my head.
But Weibold,
That isn't one of the films that starts with a THX noise, right?
No, it's not.
That's burned into my head.
That's actually a very rare occurrence on a Warner Brothers film. In fact, I think the only one that, as of right now, the only one I know that's THX certified is THX 1138, obviously.
That's interesting. Right. I never knew there was like a not magic thing. I mean, I haven't heard the THX noise in a real long time, so. We're not going to try to recreate it on this podcast.
Really? We can try harder.
No, thanks.
Do you guys know what else was
until
now
that
has? Hold on.
No, prepare yourselves.
Freaking the coming soon to DVD.
Coming soon to own on DVD and video.
I was going to say, most of the ones I remember are coming soon to own on VHS and DVD.
Yep. Prepare yourselves.
We're going totally off topic here. I learned that VHS tapes are basically all going to be unreadable in a few decades because even the newest ones, the iron that they use to magnetize the tapes, it's basically all just going to turn to dust. It's going to turn to rust. I mean, if you have a very well preserved one, yeah, but your average VHS tape is going to be basically unreadable. In a handful of decades.
Oh boy.
Interesting.
Yeah. I mean, we think we're in the age of like permanents. You know, you put something online and it'll never go away, but it's like, it's difficult to keep things together.
Yeah.
That's why you gotta convert stuff and whatever. Anyway. Anyway, let's talk about any more railroad things we have to talk about.
Yes.
Because when you mentioned THX, I was about to play the logo.
Don't play the noise.
No.
We don't need a copyright strike for the THX noise.
Do you mind if I change?
Yeah.
All right, fine, despite the crap load of videos there are of it.
There are about a million.
Can I complain about Railfan?
Someone would
say you can complain about Railfan. No.
Why is it whenever I go trackside, I don't see a thing?
What thing?
Me, IRL.
Anything. Anything, nothing at all. And then, like, I leave and trains go by.
Mm-hmm.
Like, today, I was driving down the railroad tracks because I wanted to maybe see a train. I get to where I'm going, I can't see the tracks, but I can, hear them going by. Four trains went by. Four. And I didn't see one.
Oh, my God.
For the record, I'm in a similar state as you, but when I go train spotting, the only railroad I usually see is just Union Pacific.
Yeah, but he wants to see, like, anything. Yeah. I don't end up seeing anything. I mean, I get a lot of Amtrak trains, but if I want to see a freight train, I have to, like, do a coordinated effort to either go somewhere or go somewhere, like, really early in the morning to try and catch Providence and Worcester doing something.
You know, I usually have to go to Hondo.
I mean, I do see trains quite often because I work like right down the street from the tracks. But you know, I'm not actually there to experience it.
You can hear it in the distance.
Yeah, I can. They always blow their horns and everything. I'm just like, oh, there it goes.
As you can probably guess by saying that I usually have to go to Hondo to see freight trains coming, you can probably guess which railroads occupied my area before Union Pacific took them over. Yeah. Missouri, Kansas, Texas, and Missouri Pacific, and also Southern Pacific.
Go back. Perfect sync on my end.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Anyway.
I haven't, made an effort to go rail fanning since Agilis was here. I did actually finally buy a, Agilis came to the PN to look at it, and we hung out for a little while, and he noticed one of the club cars that was for sale. And usually the ones that are on display are the display models, you know? You say, I want one of these, and we take one out of the box and give it to you.
Yes.
But this was a one-off. And I wasn't sure. I had never seen one like it before. It wasn't one of the, the mass-produced
club cars. Right, it's not like the hopper.
Yeah. It was a covered hopper with a little diamond PN logo on the side of it. And I was like, well, that's really neat. And he's like, yeah, it's really cool. I kind of want that, but I don't have the cash on me right now. And I was like, well, I don't know if that's one that, you know, there are more of, or if you're just supposed to take this one. But I don't want to tell you... Oh, no, he did have the cash. That's right. The question was, I didn't want to tell him to take that one. Nobody else was there. If it was the display model.
Right.
So I basically said, well, I'll ask about it when I get the chance, and then I'll buy it for you, and you can pay me back or whatever. Now I'm just going to send it to him, because I don't care. I'll give it to him for his birthday or something. But I finally was like, hey, I can just buy this one, right? People were like, yeah, that was a custom-made one. I was like, all right, sure. Here's $25. Let me take this club car. Now it's just sitting behind me. It's nice. It's a three-bay, straight-sided coat hopper.
Nice.
Cool.
Nice.
So, anything else?
Nice.
Not on my end.
I saw another I saw another one of the MBTA F40 rebuilds, so that was kind of neat. Nice. I saw it a little bit closer this time. But, oh, I got to do, did I talk about the commuter surveys last episode? I can't remember if that was before last episode or not. Yeah, I think.
I don't remember.
Either way, I had to do 3 days worth of commuter surveys. I think I talked about the buddy bars. Anyway.
Yeah. Oh, whoop, I forgot Sam and Shell promotion. New Albany Western stuff.
Uh-oh. Let me see.
A chop nose SD and a U for the...
God, they're orange.
Yeah.
Very orange, Milky.
Orange.
Yeah, they are.
Where the air smells orange. Like warm root beer.
Yeah.
Also, I realized the other day that, as Agilis brought this up to me, the actual reporting mark for the Providence of Worcester is WRWK.
Yep.
They took it from the Warwick Railway, which was that was their reporting mark back in the day. And it makes me think, right. What is the reporting mark for the Portland and Western?
PNWR.
Yeah, so that presumably is why...
It's PNWR.
PNWR?
Yeah.
Okay, I wonder if there's a PWRR reporting mark out there. Or maybe they just, let me check. You know.
Yeah, hang on.
Because I wonder what theirs was back in the day and why they had to go with the Warwick Railway reporting mark.
Although I thought they were PNWC because they couldn't get... I don't know.
There is no PWRR. In fact, the closest thing to PWR is PWRZ, which is Providence and Worcester.
Oh, okay. So, they own more than one, then. I was given the impression that that was theirs, and I was like, well, that would be really interesting if that was their one reporting mark, was the one that they held from the Warwick Railway way back in the day.
Yeah, let me see if it's registered on here, actually.
Well, going back to the subject of PNWR, mm-hmm. they actually have their own NIC.
They have their own what?
They have their own NIC. Look in the channel.
Oh NIC.
Different. Oh yeah.
Hey, the white PNWR. I've come close to seeing that.
WRWK is the Warwick Railway, which is listed as Warwick Railway, Providence, and Worcester Railroad.
Mm-hmm. PWR is Piedmont and Western Railroad Club.
Weird.
That's not an actual.
So, you know what I'm wondering? I'm wondering what is the oldest reporting mark still in service?
UPRR.
Is that UPRR. The oldest, though?
Probably. Because it's the only... Think about it, it's one of the only railroads that has retained its name for so long. But anything else in that area is not the same.
But it doesn't have to... It doesn't have to retain its name.
Yeah, but when was the last time you saw something for the, you know, the Central Pacific? Maybe something Canadian?
Hold on.
Maybe Canadian Pacific.
When?
Well, that, I feel like that'd still be younger than UPRR.
Yeah. Very well.
UPR was in use before reporting marks were even like a common thing. It was just a quick, easy abbreviation.
That was true.
That's true. Well, I'm wondering, because some of these companies like Pan Am, or, you know, or even the Providence of Worcester, they have reporting marks that are a lot older than the actual companies.
Yeah.
So,
actually, you know what might be older than Union Pacific?
What?
That I would not doubt has remained the same. The U.S. Army.
Hmm.
Oh, here's one though. The Maine Central, reporting mark MEC, was chartered 1856.
Ooh. So, is anybody still using MEC though?
They are. Well, Pan Am uses MEC.
Yeah. They pass it on from the Guilford Rail System, which owned MEC.
Yep. So that's what I'm talking about. I bet if you dug deep enough, you would find one that's even older. You know, I mean, what about the B&O? Is there anything that carries that on? Is there any still reporting mark? You know,
well, where is that reporting mark gone? Maybe here. Either those would be those would probably be those CSX units that just slap have the logos slapped on them.
Yeah,
stickers.
Yeah, because they would own that reporting mark. So,
or what about that CSX SC70 that was sold off to a leasing company that has CNO markings?
Yeah. Well, marking is different than reporting mark. You know, if it's painted up like one, but it has a different reporting mark. Anyway, that's just a curiosity that I'm having right now. If anybody else has anything else to talk about in their railroad sphere of influence, let's do that. If not, let's go on to the next section.
Sphere of influence is good because last night I was at my friend's house.
No. Demonetization.
Oh,
4 seconds.
I don't think they're gonna die.
Who did that?
You better be lucky Lucasfilm no longer owns TV.
They're going to take
because Lucasfilm gives a crap.
That would imply that someone from Lucasfilm actually watched the podcast.
Yeah, I'd honestly be more honored and be happier if it did. Oh, boo-hoo.
No, literally, just let me hang on. Let me show. It's owned by Razer now, company known as Razer.
Dude. Scooters.
Hang on, let me...
The scooter, the ankle killers. All right, no, sorry. Yeah. So forget the THX stuff.
Yeah.
TBA, right, what were you saying?
Oh, so railroad sphere of influence. My friend, I gave him a little lesson last night because he was curious. I showed him 4014, and he said, hey, that looks like the big one in the Railroad Museum downtown.
The big one? You mean the flying one from Gal? You mean the flying Japanese big one from Galaxy Railways?
No.
Oh, yeah, that. Oh, that.
Did he mean the Pomona Museum, TBA?
No. No, he saw the relation, you know, how the similarity between a cab forward and 4014.
Yeah,
gotcha.
Wrong. So I was, no, I'm kidding.
I explained to him because he wanted to know more about it and why it was backwards. And so I got to tell that story to him and how the cab forward came to be.
Oh, that's pretty
Yob Gib.
He thought that was cool.
The cab forward is just a Yob Gib.
At least he was more keen to knowing why it was backwards, unlike Connor from the full Buccaneers.
Cab backwards. I learned
him something last
You learned him some. Also, you rip in peaceful Buccaneers.
Yeah.
Anyway. I think that's about it.
All right. Well.
Does our guest have anything?
That'd be you, Bears.
No.
I plan on seeing 4014 sometime later.
Hey.
It's supposed to come down to my area sometime next month.
Hey. That's good.
So I'll probably be able to see it.
We have a really interesting article about that. Make sure that I cover it.
Okay.
And by interesting, I mean kind of funny, because, oh my god. It's something special.
It's disappointing.
It's disappointing on a number of levels.
Yes.
Alright. Another thing, hang on, I'm trying to remember it. Like, another thing I want to talk about is this Conrail caboose I found. Like, I can't, like, it was a Conrail, like, it was a caboose from, hang on, I need to find a photo of it.
Found it how? Like, found a model of it, like, or, like, found it in a field?
It was, like, it was a picture I found of a caboose that was apparently, that had a Conrail reporting mark on it, and the weirdest thing about it is, If I can actually find the, wretched photo of it.
Yeah.
Well, it read, I think, Conrail of, hang on, trying to remember
Rio
the
Grand,
name.
Rio Grande Great Western.
Rio Grande
Great Western, yeah.
Denver and Rio Grande Great Western, mind you.
Like, if I recall correctly, it read something like Conrail, like, actually, you know what, I'm gonna shift this topic to something else. When you take a locum, like that one time, like trying to hang on.
Train the
like
thought.
It was a GP7, but
yeah,
basically it was a EMD Jeep lettered for Lionel Lines.
Oh, okay.
A real one?
Yeah, a real one. Trying to see if I can find a photo of it.
Suffering Pacific.
These folks, man, finding photos I've seen once are damn near impossible.
Also, Hustle Muscle. Hustle Muscle might be my favorite, just like, we were having fun in the shop, so we made this.
Yeah.
You know what's interesting? What's fun? It's kind of ironic, given that the SD45 could break its own crankshaft. And that happened to it fairly recently. Has so much muscle.
Not enough hustle.
Not enough hustle.
You're supposed to pull trains, not pull muscles.
Pulling muscles hurts.
Pull muscles.
Yes, it does. I'd imagine breaking a crankshaft does too.
Yeah.
Oh, and speaking of Lionel Lines, do you guys remember that time where they relettered 765 as 726?
I don't. There are enough 760 whatevers. Yeah. There's like a million of those burks around. I'd love to see them together.
But here's the, like, they did, and I'm just sitting here like, okay, Lionel, you're not fooling anyone.
Okay. Well,
Strasburg and Golang couldn't fool me when they did Norfolk and Western 475 as Indian Valley 475.
Dude, the goal is not to fool people.
gotcha.
Yeah.
Just to state the obvious there.
If you're Lionel, the goal is to make money. But anyway, if you're in Locomotive Versus, the goal is to win. It's what you do. So that means it's time for...
THX noise.
THX noise. Locomotive Versus.
Is that
going to
be... You will not believe how many Disney DVDs I have that have the THX sound.
Anyway, corner...
Work about a versus.
Yeah. In one corner, we have...
This boy!
Union
Werewolf!
It's your boy.
It's your boy, Big Chungus.
Big Chungus. By the way, I'm representing the Union Railroad Trust. O-10-2. That's weird to say.
It is, in fact, an O-10-2. And I am representing the one that we all know and love, Ivan.
Ivan will not go. Ivan will not go.
So, we have, effectively, a 2-10-0 versus an 0-10-2.
Yeah.
And we really just want to see what wins, the conventional decapod or the really chonk decapod facing the wrong direction.
This will be a good locomotive versus.
If the 0-10-2
the DuPaste.
If the 0-10-2 wins, I want to know what is a match for it. I really want to know. Yeah. Anyway, so who do you guys think should go first?
The 0-10-2 should go first because it's different.
It's so, like...
Well, we're sorry, but it can only go backwards.
Yeah.
All right, Milky, go ahead.
When you want a cab forward, but put the cab on the right way.
Dopa.
Why won't you got rid of both of the links?
Dopa.
Why did it? Why did it get rid of that? Hang on.
Please put them back because I need that.
Plug backwards. There.
It's the dew paste.
No, it's the one is the decapod, the other one is the dopa deck.
Got it.
Anyway,
the DM, there's actually one dopa deck on display based on what I'm seeing.
Yep.
One in Greenville.
Yes. Yes.
Spoilers.
Creator.
Anyway, all right, Milky, go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. By the way, what year were you built?
I was built in 1924.
1936.
Wow, such a name. Oh boy.
How many of you were built?
One.
Nine.
The only time we're nine kids in this weirdo oddball class.
Well, I got that on my system.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. What's your number in craft?
Thanks. One.
Nine.
I highly doubt that, considering you know great what the real like. Actually, never mind, because I'm thinking too
hard. There was only one. There was only 190.
Yeah. Dog, come on.
All right.
Okay. What is your minimum weight of whale?
I think you have made a mistake. My minimum weight of rail
thank
is
you as well.
My minimum weight of rail is 63 pounds per yard.
Stump a bit.
Damn, drum roll.
I have dug myself a hole already. 115.
Jesus Christ.
It worked for the DM and IR. Like,
yeah.
That iron coming out of their ears. Like, we need heavier rails. Why don't we just make the ground out of rail?
We're going to pave the planet.
We're going to cast a new mountain to go over.
Okay, so, okay. Here's what we're going to do.
For an utterly cringeworthy environmental message.
Here's what we're going to do. What is your engine wheelbase?
32 feet.
32 feet. Mine is 28 feet.
All right.
I'm keeping an eye on what we have, you know, different here. What is your overall wheelbase?
Overall wheelbase, 67.23.
64 feet even.
Wait, what?
64 feet even.
How is that even possible?
Because I'm smaller. Because he's huge. Yeah. He's fair fat. Point.
He's moto moto.
Oh god.
Sorry. Don't. All right. People, don't start that meme.
It's time. What is your factor of adhesion?
Oh no, this is gonna be bad.
3.78.
Ooh, not good, but not as bad as I thought. Okay, mine is 4.08, so I'm pretty close.
Better.
Ivan's pretty good.
You're slightly more chonk than you should be.
Just barely, though. I need to lose a couple of pounds, but, you know, a little while on the treadmill, it'll do me fine. I can't see much from this dead-on side view. I can't tell how big the tender is. Hold on. So this is... I need to look something up real quick. DMIR... I just want a better picture. I want a different angle.
Hang on.
There aren't a lot of good pictures of them.
Yeah. I mean, I think we found out that there really aren't a lot of good pictures of a lot of DM and IR engines.
Yeah. Nobody ever went and rail fanned up there because it's too freaking cold.
Okay. Like, no one went up. Where the rail?
Over up in where?
To Duluth.
No. Yeah, people. Yeah,
the Great White North.
They can't go to Duluth because it's too cold. Yet they could still go to Alaska. It seems.
At least Alaska's neat.
No, the difference is they're stuck in Alaska.
Stuck.
They can't get out.
All right, so I don't think I'm gonna win any of those statistics. Oh, you know what I can do? I can press my advantage here. What is your tender loaded weight?
Lots.
13 tons.
No. Not how many, not how much coal you have. What is your tender loaded weight?
Oh. Dope.
Well, now Ellis has to stay away from that one.
I knew anyway. I looked.
Okay, tender order weight 240,000.
Wow, 161,000.
Oof.
That's
a big tender.
Yeah. What is your what is your engine weight?
404,300.
212,000 pounds. I am very light for a decapod.
Yeah, you are.
Light.
I think it would have been more fair to do the
That's a feather.
The O-10-2 versus like the I-1.
Yeah.
You know, something, something just as ridiculously heavy as it. Anyway, what is your axle loading?
Mid-chunk is first boobs. Axle loading. Axle loading. 70,000.
38,000. It's almost half. It's half. Crap, I can't breathe.
Stop drinking.
Okay. That one might do me in. Let me try some other things before I come back to that. What is your total engine and tender weight?
644,300.
373,000 pounds. What is your... That probably won't help me, so I'm not going to ask that. That definitely won't help me. And I don't think any of the things down there are going to help me, so... there's just a point at which if you go lower than it, it just... It doesn't...
It's not good.
All right, I'll try...
I'll look at it this way.
I'll try this. What is your ratio of driving wheelbase to overall engine wheelbase?
Ah, that's a nice one for me.
0.69.
Nice. 0.7.
Oof.
That's
0.69 isn't actually that great.
Way to be those guys. Great Western Sugar Company.
Yeah.
It doesn't really have the same ring to it, does it?
No, it doesn't. Alright, so I think I've done everything that I can do safely, so now it's time to ask, what is your builder?
Baldwin.
Damn it! Alright.
There's one thing they have
also
in common.
Baldwin.
One's a Baldwin, the other's a Baldwin.
Damn it. Alright, Milky, Baldwin. Continue.
Okay.
I'm in danger.
Help, I'm in danger.
I'm in danger.
Okay, danger,
little woman.
To my friend Ivan, what is your driver diameter?
Driver diameter is proud 56 inch.
61.
Sure, not a grower.
Duh. Alright, you win. Next.
High-pressure cylinders.
High-pressure cylinders, 24 by 28.
28 by 32.
Jesus Christ.
Wow.
I knew they looked big, but dang.
Yeah.
Like, damn, boy.
Tractive effort.
Tractive effort is, I think, you win. It is 46,512 pounds.
Oh, yeah, I do win. 90,893.
Yeah, I was just curious if you were in the six figures or not.
Good lord.
The
I don't know about you, but something about the Union Railroad O-10-2s, their design, something about it looks like something the Virginian Railroad would have owned.
Yeah.
If I look at the front end of it, if ignoring the boobs, it looks almost like an I-1. It's that thing. yeah. Anyway, Milky, continue.
You really want to make a joke about that. Funny. Some people did that with the I-1 essays.
Yeah. My favorite pair of boobs.
Yeah.
about that.
But anyway, right. back on course. Firebox area.
Oh boy. 197 square feet.
Well, with Milky's domination.
448.70.
Jesus Christ.
448.
Yeah.
That's a huge firebox.
The big firebox game showed up.
Yeah, there are two pictures. Sorry.
It still exists.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, could you imagine if that imagine if that 0102 that's in Greenville got restored to operation?
It would break everything. Anyway, Milky, continue.
Okay, what's your grade area, dude?
Oh my god. Grade area is 54.30 square feet.
50, or minus 85.25.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Okay.
Evaporating.
2,343.
4,800.
Oh my god.
Super perfect.
553.
1,398.
You're like doubling me.
Yes.
You have like twice as much as I do.
Give me combined heating surface.
Combined heating surface is 2,896.
Let me guess.
6,197.
You say 6,000?
Yep.
Oh, I thought it was 4,000. Honest with you.
Yeah.
You know how Timothy's pretty much been double of Ivan.
I need an adult.
I need a... For those playing at home, we can now go to style points.
Yeah.
Oh, but I ain't done yet.
No! Please lose one and I'll take it to style points.
Brace yourself.
You've been...
Your ass is grass and he's a lawnmower.
Okay. Evaporating surface divided by cylinder volume.
159.81.
210.83.
That was my one hope. And I knew I wasn't going
to... Wobber J. Messina's power cavitation.
10,317.
22,165.
That's more than double.
Same as above both superheroes.
Hold on, I need to rack up your points.
Stop, he's already dead.
12,277. 12,277.
Okay. Okay, 27,041. Okay. You know what I'm going to do next? Same as above, but substitute firebox area for grade area.
44,542.
142,320.
Jesus! How? That's like three times as much. It's possible because it's effing huge.
Okay, you made your point. I mean,
favorite question been asked yet?
What?
Robert Lee Messina's
power.
That
was he doubled me. I had 10,000, he had like 22,000.
Power.
I don't know about you, but something about the engine's boiler reminds me of Bessemer and Lake Erie 643.
I mean they're old chunk. Power L1, 10,046.
22,663 power MT.
Okay.
That's 10 times as much.
Power MT 582.83.
Ooh, you got quotes.
Damn it.
But not quite. But 700.
The slaughter must continue.
Even 726.36. Even the ones where we're normally able to turn it around, I've just been... I'm dead.
There's a massive amount of destruction going. Okay.
Flex tape can't fix that.
Yeah. Fuel capacity.
Fuel, 12 tons.
14
tons. Yeah.
You know what? And why not to round it all out, for the most part, except for one question that's more morbid curiosity, but we'll get to that. Tender water capacity.
Tender water capacity, 8,000 gallons.
12,000. I thought you were going to win that for reverie.
You guys are huge. Your tender's huge. It's not huge, but it's bigger than mine.
Okay.
Wow. And the one that I want you to ask.
Yoko base ID.
11,372.
Oof. I'm 5,976.
You've hit 20 points and we're not even in style points.
That is uncanny.
If you hadn't
stop, he's dead.
If you hadn't turned it over to me, you could have gotten to 20 points and gone to style points, and I still would have had none.
You know what?
Yeah.
I like to get mercy.
Right.
Uh-huh.
Anyway.
You know who doesn't like mercy?
You.
Well, I guess ready for style points.
I guess it's time for style points.
All right, Weibel, do your thing.
So the six of, or the Duke of Poot or whatever. The Pooka dude. The Pooka dude has a doghouse, which is cool. It has greedy boards, which even adds more to the coal capacity.
Yep.
It has a booster under the tender, which is really
of
cool.
Of effing course it does.
It has two cross-compound air compressors, which is more than you have.
Yep.
It has two dynamos for some bizarre reason. It has safety stripes on the switcher boards.
Yeah. Does it? Hold on.
Yeah, on the footboards for the pilot. It has safety stripes.
Okay.
It's very safe. It has dual snifters on each piston, which is, you know, cool.
More than I have.
Yep. And then I don't know how many sand lines you have. I closed down my picture of 90. Because he definitely has a higher sand capacity. He may also have more means of distributing it,
which
he does.
Yeah, he does.
He has four sand lines as opposed to two.
All wire cab?
Yep.
Also, not to mention, 604 has white walls.
Yep. Well, so the... Oh, wait.
90 did on the Great Western.
It depends on the scheme. You know, 90's been in all these different paint schemes now.
Yeah.
Only a matter of time before Lero Productions uses it for one of their charters.
I'm surprised they haven't, honestly. Anyway.
Because there's a Great Western Sugar engine in Great Western Sugar country that nobody touches, ever.
Why can't 90 just haul an auto train?
51?
Oh, yeah. Okay,
just sits.
I have a greater survivor percentage.
This is true. You have also run in preservation, which I don't think this monstrosity has.
Thank God.
Were these things retired, Milky?
Hang on, let me check.
Milky, when were these things retired?
They operated well into the 50s.
Okay, well...
When were they retired?
Hold up. I'm getting there. Okay.
And Ellis, I suppose the same of you, really.
I mean,
hold up.
Let me look this up.
Now you're making me have to do research on my engine. apparently 1963.
1964 at least.
Damn it.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, then.
The entry here on Steam Locomotive is, after more than 40 years of service, 90 was sold to the Strasburg Railroad. Okay, so in 1967, it was sold.
Yeah.
So.
And also, unlike the Chonk, 90 yards of running excursion for Ross Roland.
That just puts you in danger. Cool.
We've already done it in preservation.
Yeah, running in preservation is just one point.
This was Ross Roland before 614.
Still, I mean, you know. Yeah. Old habits die hard, I guess.
Yeah.
Fair point.
Yeah, I don't know how I don't know how else I would get any points here.
Alright, continue.
I'm so very, very dead. Yeah, we're gonna have to do this thing against the I-1, but
yeah. Trains model?
30
points. I mean, I do have a trains model.
Do I?
That's a good question.
I don't know.
I want to find out if I do.
As always, Paul's trains does not count.
Oh, God.
Since when has Paul's trains counted?
Never.
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 Exactly.
Never.
I do have a
bonus point for having a K&L model.
Yeah, well, I'm giving it a point for that and a point for, well, being Ivan.
I do not have a trains model, but I do have a physical one.
I think we have physical models of both.
Yeah, of course. Because everyone makes brass everything.
Well, and everyone makes Strasburg everything. They're famous as well. Yeah, okay, so definitely, I was going to leave this slot open for, a suggestion, but I absolutely have to put in this versus the I-1, because it has to happen. I need it to happen.
Oh my god, yes! Though I've learned one thing from the O-10-2 against Ivan.
It's really freaking big.
It's pretty much the chunkier, stronger clone of Ivan.
Oh, we have another Decapod versus up here in the locomotive versus thing. We have the I-1 versus the Western Maryland I-2. So we could have, the Decapod 2 against...
We could do a royale of Decapods and Puka Dudes.
Royale.
Oh, God.
Versus the Puka Dude.
You know what's ironic? You know what's hilarious to me?
What?
The Southern Pacific called their Santa Fe types Decapods.
Yes. Because you don't call them what they're supposed to be called, because they're them.
In fairness, Decapod just means beast with 10 legs, so really a Decapod could be anything with 10 drivers. Legs.
That's true.
But that is what Decapod means.
But emphasis on the beast part when it comes to the DM and IR things. Anyway, I think I'm going to concede.
I'm in the beast.
Yeah.
If somebody makes a trade while that, I want to see a Beauty and the Beast parody with some other locomotive.
There are plenty of other locomotives you could do that with. There are plenty of other locomotives.
Someone someone in the Trains content creation Discord made a model of the Norfolk and Western John Henry.
You could do it with
Beauty and the Thief.
There you go.
Giving me a Castle Cagliostro reminder, and I'm not happy about it for some reason.
Beauty and the Thief would be like grinning on pin.
Anyway, all right, let's cast our votes here.
Why must I not go in the West Wing? Thief. Votes.
Yeah. Okay. 10 votes.
I vote for Ivan, because Ivan.
I vote for Ivan too, but that's mainly because I'm more familiar with Strasburg 90.
I honestly like the Puka Dude. I think it's cool.
I would probably vote for it too, because when it wins like that...
That's a good locomotive for as ridiculous as it is on principle.
What was the final score? 30 to 12?
30 to 14.
30 to 14. Ugh.
You didn't do that bad. You almost got half of what he did.
Oh man, this entire locomotive versus in a nutshell.
It's been a while since we've had a trouncing that bad.
Oh my god. Well, because usually you can even it up. Usually you can even it up with the with the lower weights and stuff. Anyway, all right, let's talk about some news.
All right, I'll tap the locomotive versus thing by saying this. According to all known laws of railroad physics, there's no way the O-10-2 would have been able to operate. It's a fat boiler moving. Yeah. But the O-10-2, of course, operated anyway. Because the O-10-2 did not care about what humans thought was impossible.
Anyway, there's our...
That's better.
Horseman Whoa. Universe movie.
So,
speaking of K&L, because Ivan has a K&L model. K&L recently swapped out one of the things on its project list. Unexpected,
oh, no.
And it turns out that there was a post about this subject because A24 is not canceled. It's being delayed until the license that Laro filed with Union Pacific becomes valid. So he's looking to make it properly licensed.
What?
Yeah.
Interesting.
He's partnering with Union Pacific to make the model.
Wow.
So
that's the reason why the backshops is delaying their Union Pacific models. So they have to work out a license with UP.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not sure that they have to.
No, but it gets you access to more stuff. But anyway, the takeaway here, the other part of it is it's been replaced by 4.25 from the Reading and Northern.
Woo.
Now the Reading and Northern I'm going to talk about them for a minute.
Like Ivan. Or look like Ivan.
We talked about the Lehigh Gorge Scenic not paying its taxes last episode.
Tax man.
And so the long and short of it is that if you are operating in the borough, you have to pay an amusement tax on anything that's entertainment based. You pay like a 5% tax on you know, any revenue you take in. So 5% of the ticket sales. As stated in the articles that came out about this, generally amusements will just add the 5% onto the ticket price. You know, whatever. It's not a big deal. It's 5%. The Lehigh Gorge has been avoiding this tax for at least 5 years and is almost six figures in debt in back taxes. So, and not only are they six figures in debt, they also refuse to pay it. In fact, to the point of they are raising the middle finger to the borough and... Thank you.
Taking their streets and training them, putting their something.
Yeah, they're raising the middle finger to the borough and saying, we are no longer going to be operating out of Jim Thorpe. In fact, we are ceasing operations because we are not going to pay this tax. You know what their rationale for not wanting to pay the tax is? And I quote, the Lehigh Gorge Scenic Railroad has made it clear to the borough council that it is not an amusement, and it will not pay any so-called amusement tax.
There could be a point there, but
no, they're not an amusement. I don't
know, maybe I'm just biased in saying with the railroad here.
I mean,
yeah.
You could argue the definition of an amusement, I suppose. But what an amusement is outlined in the tax code. It's not to be.
Does it? The railroad.
But what if no one has fun on the train?
Okay. Yeah. But it's providing, doing something, it was in the article from last week, so I don't have it anymore, but it's generally for the purposes of providing entertainment and that sort of thing. You know, like the theater has to pay it, park rides have to pay it, you know, whatever. The Lehigh Gorge is literally just a scenic train ride. They're not asking for the revenue from the RNN or freight operations, yada, yada, yada. Mm-mm. They're not an amusement, they say. I guess. Right.
I mean, I could see both, honestly.
Yeah.
It's an unamusement park.
How are they not an amusement? I mean, are you not supposed to enjoy yourself?
Are we about
to if it's a historic thing before it is an amusement, or supposed to be a historic thing before it's an amusement, then that might not count as an amusement.
I guess, but it...
You know, it's not something that is obviously an amusement like a movie theater or a, you know, Chuck E. Cheese. It's... I don't know. I personally agree. I think, yes, it counts as an amusement. The railroad's probably just kind of pissed off because, like they say in the article, they operated out of Jim Thorpe as not a moneymaker, but more of a kind of good, you know, sort of a gesture of, hey, let's have this really neat thing for the community because we don't make a lot of money off of it, but why not?
But that's like saying, well, we've done so much for your community, we shouldn't have to pay taxes. It's like everybody else does it, all the other entertainments do it.
I'm not saying that it's right, I'm saying that I understand why the railroad might be a little bit miffed about having to pay a tax that in their eyes they might not...
Yeah.
But you know, in their eyes it doesn't apply to them.
But here's the other thing, and this is what got me. Because we were talking about this in the fan chat quite a bit and looked into it. This is not a new tax. The tax has been in place since, if I recall correctly from the brief research that we did, the tax has been in place since before the Lehigh Gorge Scenic started operations. And apparently they paid it until 2016.
Well, that hurts their case considerably.
So, again, I don't... It's just, I mean, it's terrible that they're deciding to back out, but I just am amused with their rationale. As we are not an amusement. You should not enjoy this. Amusement tax, yeah, so in the other one, in the other thing it broke down what the amusement tax is, and I mean, I feel like a museum would still have to pay that tax, even if it was just a museum. Because you go there to be entertained and look at things.
You don't, though. You go there to be educated.
Yeah, but if you wanted to be educated on the stuff, you don't have to witness it.
I'm not arguing this as an actual thing, because, again, I side mostly with you. I'm arguing from the political, like, if you were a hard line, you know, you're with the railroad and you're trying to make a legal case, you could argue that the primary role of a museum type thing is not to be entertained, it's to be educated. And then the railroad is more of a museum than a amusement, so it's not amusement, it's educational.
Yeah, but this isn't even what they're doing here. This is not a museum.
Well, because, like, well, it depends, though. Is a historic site amusement? It's not a museum.
No, I'm saying this isn't.
It's not a museum, yes, but is a historic site amusement? Because it's not a museum either.
I don't... Again, they seem to paint it as... Again, I don't have the quotation, but it was... For the purposes of providing entertainment. I mean, you could argue that a museum is just for education, but at the end of the day, it's not just for education. You know, you can learn about stuff without going to a museum. You can, you know...
You can be amused without going to a railroad.
And those both are true. But only one of those entails a tax.
This is true. Again, I'm not arguing against you. I'm just saying that's probably some of their rationale. I don't think it's ridiculous for them to think this. The fact that they paid the tax up to 2016 and then just stopped, that one really, really hurts their case here.
Yeah, I don't think... I doubt that they actually think this. Because, frankly, I think just looking at it, from the outside, from a layman's point of view, and seeing the scenic railroad call themselves not an amusement is kind of absurd.
That to me is one of the least absurd parts about this.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Anyway.
But
not to say it's not absurd. Again, it is absurd. But the different angles. The them just stopping paying the tax, I think, is the nail in the coffin of, like, no, you guys don't really have an argument here.
Yeah.
Your own logic does not apply to this.
Yeah.
Speaking of, your own logic does not apply to this.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Como.
Oh, boy.
Is no longer the worst, weirdest, whatever you want to call it, in town. There's a new Como in town.
There's a new Como in town. That's podcast title number 3.
There is a new Como in town. They call themselves the Central City Railroad and Mining Museum. And they have a proposition for you.
Oh, no.
The Central City Railroad and Mining Museum is a new nonprofit 501c3, which is a charitable organization.
But are they
in that's a very good question. Yeah. In Central City, entertainment is less... is more laxly taxed, I guess, because they have casinos everywhere. But either way, they have obtained the lease on the Colorado Central Railroad Section House and Depot in Central City, and they have proposed to the city to take their locomotive, CNS number 71, and the combine car that sits behind it, number 20, to restore them to operation and start the greatest tourist railroad in the history of ever. although they don't have any initial budgeting figures out, their first year expected ridership is roughly 95,000 people, which, to those that don't know, is about twice the ridership of the Cumbres and Toltec, and getting close to, you know, it's more in the neighborhood of the Valley Railroad, the Durango and Silverton, the Strasburg Railroad. Essentially, they would expect to, in their first few years of operation, grow to be the largest and most traveled scenic railroad in the world.
Well, I mean,
they would do this with one locomotive, 4 cars that they would get from somewhere, they don't know, an engine house that they actually posted a blueprint of that was photocopied from a model railroader magazine because all the materials are like cardstock, literally.
Amazing.
Yeah.
They would run on a mile of track back and forth that they would have to go through private property, and they would have to relay all of it. And that's it. They think that this will work somehow.
You know what, Weibel?
And I will say...
I'd like to see their spreadsheet.
Yeah, their spreadsheet doesn't work. Their spreadsheet is not very good. And the ridiculousness of this idea is only half of the amusement, because, of course, it got posted to the... yes. Well, it's our amusement. It's not taxed then.
Yeah.
It was posted to the Narrow Gauge Forum, and I thought Rio Grande foamers were catty. This got posted to the forum. people went nuts. They are not in favor of this idea. People on the forum hate this idea. They are despised.
Apparently,
the people behind this, and I can't confirm this because I don't know any of the names involved. Like, that's the level of out of left field this is. I've never heard of anybody that's involved.
Involved what?
This thing.
Como
they're
two.
Apparently the same people. Yeah, Como 2. They're apparently the same people that tried to do the exact same thing in the 80s.
Oh, no.
And the 70s.
Wait,
and it didn't work then, and they, by most accounts, pretty much destroyed the locomotive.
Okay.
And now they're attempting to do it again, and people are not happy. There is a meeting on Wednesday in Blackhawk that I am actually planning on attending, where they're going to have a public hearing so that people can share some thoughts and opinions, and I'm half tempted to bring some popcorn.
Oh, no.
Just to watch the fireworks.
Can we get
and
a recording of this?
I am really, really tempted to, because, man, this could be interesting.
Can you just go there and pretend to be a botany, reporter, and just set up a camera and say, I'm with the Iron Horseman, I'm reporting.
Oh, jeez.
You are Weibel, representing the Iron Horseman Railroad. The railroad that
got, no, his name is Mike.
That went bankrupt and got absorbed into the car railroad and became his own identity later
Mike
on.
Mike Cross. How do you do? At this point, I'm just tempted to... I have no idea who is involved with this. I don't know any of the names behind it. The names that are signed on the forums or whatever, I've never heard of them. It's not even like, oh yeah, fuck that guy. I have no idea who these people are. Their names just don't come up. It's like Voldemort or something.
Wait, so what was the engine they destroyed?
CNS-71, the same engine that they're planning to use.
Oh, God.
You've got to be serious.
I am serious.
And don't call... Wait a minute.
Me, Shirley?
No.
Okay, can we have some good news? Because I have some good news.
I don't know if this is good news, but this is interesting, crazy news.
Okay, so we've gone from bad news to worse news to interesting crazy news. What is this?
So a uniformed BNSF officer shot and killed a upset customer who drove their truck through a Chick-fil-A.
Damn it.
I opened this article. You know, of course the headline is uniformed BNSF officer shoots killed disgruntled customer. And I'm like, yikes, that sounds bad. And then gets worse.
Wait, what?
Again, though, is that better or worse? Would it be better if the railroad cop had shot, like, somebody that ships with the railroad?
I mean, it's just...
It's not good either way,
it's
but
not.
It's just worse.
Why is this guy so upset at Chick-fil-A?
Yeah, so...
F your nuggets!
Again, that's what...
He's all upset with Chick-fil-A. Like, well, how come he hasn't just... How come he's so upset? Like, why is he upset with Chick-fil-A?
Apparently something about a sandwich.
He's locked in Chick-fil-loaded.
The sandwich?
All right.
What is this? Popeye?
No, apparently he was yelling, it's just a pink sandwich. And then he went outside, okay, got in his truck, and drove it through the wall of the building.
All right.
Yeah, and so, and then he got out and was yelling at people, and the BNSF cop told him to stand down, and he didn't.
It's just a fucking sandwich.
Why is that reminding me of a KFC restaurant where that got blown up by a gas leakage?
Well, this was definitely not an accident.
There is very little relation.
Yeah.
Okay.
The cop was like, calm down and back off, but the guy kept approaching, so the cop pulled his gun and shot him. Yikes.
I don't think the railroad cop has any authority to do that.
I don't think so either, but apparently this guy had like a stun gun or something.
Well, if it's in self-defense, then...
Yeah.
I mean, he's also a railroad officer. I mean, he's gonna have...
Yeah, but he's in a Chick-fil-A.
Even then, a railroad cop, even on the railroad's property, doesn't have a lot of legal authority.
Yeah.
If it was a Chick-fil-A in a BNSF dining car...
I think it was justified.
I think it was justified.
The window.
I think it was
I'm not saying it's not justified. That's kind of a sticky legal thing to get into. It's like, well, you've shot a man.
Yeah. I mean, whatever.
I mean, we get all up, the public gets all up in arms when, like, real cops shoot, you know, criminals. This is a dude that was just aggroed at a Chick-fil-A getting shot by a railroad bull. It's like, there's some gray areas there.
Yeah,
no, there definitely is. I can see that.
Aggro to Chick-fil-A. All right, you pull aggro. I'll get the train.
I didn't check. Did I get a point?
No, but you probably should have. Okay, let's have some actual good news for a second.
All right.
I got some good news.
All right, I'll tell you one good news.
What's your good news?
The Metro Burlington Heritage Unit has made its first run.
Hey.
I don't like Metro Heritage Units. I don't think they can do them very well. I know they're great to have, but I haven't yet come across one that I'm like, that looks really good.
Yeah.
Usually it's like, although okay.
Although I admire them trying to stay true to the CB&Q silver paint, like the stainless, like the shiny metallic silver paint that most CB&Q diesels had. Like,
I mean, they're doing it. They did do it. They made it look like it's supposed to. If CB&Q had one of these things, but it doesn't look good.
Yeah, it's the trouble is it's not an F unit. The lines are completely different.
It doesn't translate well to the F40PH M-2.
Okay, here's some actual good news that looks really good. It was Castle Waterville and Farmington has made it across the bridge.
Yay!
So, a couple weekends, last weekend, Columbus Day weekend, was the, Capone Day weekend, was the,
I forgot.
WWF work week, work weekend, rather, fall work weekend, and they crossed the Troutbrook Bridge, which was the bridge they received a few months ago.
It's the covered, not covered bridge.
Yeah, it looks like it should be a covered bridge, but it isn't. It's so exciting to see number 9 on that bridge.
That is.
And all the work they
That's
put into
really
it.
Cool.
Yep. They had like
That's got to be a good feeling too.
I'm sure. And it means that they're that much closer to the bottom of the hill, which means that they'll be able to run excursions that way. They've been waiting on that because they run excursions to the top of the mountain, and then on the other side of the top of the mountain is a relatively, I guess for them, steep downgrade. And it's downhill all the way to the road. And they said, we're not going to run trains down that side of the mountain until we've made it all the way to the bottom of the hill. Because we don't want to run away with passengers on board. So this means they're that much closer. They laid a lot of track.
Yeah. I mean, running away down the mountain isn't such a bad thing. It's good that you waited until they got over the river, though.
Yeah, that's also bad.
That's probably a bit more key than getting all the way down the mountain, is you don't run away into a creek.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't spook them yourself.
But TJ and I got to see the actual, like, they have a topographical map of the area posted in, like, their crew lounge, if you could call it that. And they have all sorts of stuff called out, Troutbrook, and there's another area that's called Pinch Point, where they're basically on as close as it gets to a cliff. Where there's the river down below them, and there's a steep, you know, hill to the side of them, and some of it's washed out, and they're like, we're looking forward to getting there, because it's going to be an effort to get that area stabilized and get through there. So I assume that's next, if they haven't already made it through it. But, yeah, I'm looking forward to them making it to the road and to the bottom of the hill, which they're the same place. But they're going to be building another passing siding down there. They wanted to build a Y so they could, you know, turn the train around there. But I don't think there's room
for it. Oh, that's why.
I heard that. The idea was tossed around that they could build another turntable down there to just turn an engine around. But, you know, they can run it in reverse.
Yeah.
So, once they get down to the bottom of the hill, they'll be at the road. And so, basically, they're going to work on stuff that they already have. They're going to be building their shingle mill and stuff like that before they decide to try and cross an actual public road. Because, you know, that entails a lot.
Because rabbit holes.
Because rabbit holes and particularly brakes. Because they have their not quite working prototype vacuum brake thing.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I talk to you? Sorry if I didn't discuss the other thing I wanted to talk about.
Sure.
It's the fact that CSX and Union Pacific are starting to face competition against trucks as if this was the 1960s.
Or to rule the world.
Since when? Why is this they're starting to face competition? They have been facing competition.
That's just what the article says. This article seems kind of scatterbrained.
Like they're trying. They're start. Yeah, I'm kind of a scatterbrain to be honest.
No, the article, not you.
No.
I'm a smart scatterbrain, though.
Okay.
Blame me back to that.
Customers. Also, I like how there's the title is about CSX and Union Pacific. The video is about Amtrak. The blurb is about Amtrak. And then it goes back into CSX and UP, basically talking about PSR and how it's scaring away customers. And then you can't read the full story.
I don't know.
I don't understand. I assume some of these articles get written by robots. That might be one of them.
There's probably a point in here somewhere to be had.
There might be a point in here somewhere. There's a point in this, though, and the point is to ride Amtrak. So this is a Business Insider article about riding coast to coast on an Amtrak train. It says, it took me 96 hours to ride an Amtrak train from coast to coast. I'd do it again in a heartbeat. And I entitled this on the document Amtrak Propaganda because, frankly, I love the amount of articles that have been coming out lately of people, you know, writing for these big papers and saying, I really enjoyed my trip with Amtrak. Maybe this is like the guerrilla marketing. Maybe this is what Anderson is doing.
Guerrilla radio.
Over 96 hours, I saw more of the U.S. than I ever have before, he says. And this is, it's a long, it's a very well-written article about going from Penn Station to, let's see, where did he go to? I assume he went to Sacramento, but I think he actually might have gone, okay, no, that's right, he went to Seattle. So he took the Empire Builder, and I believe... Which one did he take? Okay, so he took the Lakeshore Limited and the Empire Builder. So, yeah.
Okay.
Fantastic.
Speaking of Amtrak, some good news from Amtrak, actually, for a change.
More good news.
More good news. Amtrak is growing, apparently.
Yeah.
Growing. Well, you know, here's the Surfliner, they're adding... two new trains a day, one in each direction, between San Diego and Los Angeles.
The Surfliner gets a lot of traffic.
And the Surfliner does already get a lot of traffic.
Also, and holy crap, why is this article in mobile format? I can't read this. Okay, there we go, sorry. The other one here is not necessarily about Amtrak growth, but how Amtrak could grow fairly easily. It's a really, really well-written article.
Yeah.
I
encourage everybody to read it. It's going to be down in the cargos. Again, it really shines a light on things that Amtrak could be doing, which would make their market a hell of a lot better without that much work. But one of the other things is closing certain gaps, like, parts of states.
The wage gap.
Parts of states that they don't currently access. Right, Melky?
Yeah, like Eastern Oregon, which hasn't had an Amtrak train since 1997, when they discontinued the Pioneer, which, for those at home that don't know what the Pioneer was, it was a train that traveled from Portland to Chicago through Salt Lake City.
Didn't it also go via Cheyenne?
Fantastic.
Did it do that, or am I thinking of something different? Because I remember at one point you had, like, two trains that left Denver, and one went through Moffett Tunnel, and the other one went...
That was the Desert Wind.
Okay, sorry.
Close, but both trains that should be back. But anyway, there's a group of advocates in Eastern Oregon that want their Pioneer back.
Not Pioneer!
And I agree with them. And... the towns are on board with it. The Grand, in particular, is really on board with the idea, and hopefully some good can come out of it. And they're holding a meeting on Saturday, the 26th. So they're basically trying to get a built or a summit together and get people together to talk about this.
Now, I'd like to contrast the article that TBA mentioned with this other Amtrak article that I didn't pull out because I didn't really like it that much, and I don't like the premise. It's the two Amtrak concept, which talks about splitting Amtrak basically into the Northeast Corridor and other tight little regional routes, and then making the long-distance routes a completely separate thing that are bookkept differently and funded differently and whatever.
No.
Don't get me wrong, I think there's merit for this. I think there's merit for the idea. But that, in my mind, it just makes it so much easier to close that.
It
puts that in its own thing, so we can say, well, we don't need this anymore, and they can shut down the entire program with one fell swoop. It's lining it up to, it's lining it up to be obliterated. I don't know.
Yeah.
This article does, however, talk about the Southwest chief. I mean, it talks about a lot of the problems. I just don't like the conclusion that they come to. I don't agree with it.
Yeah.
No,
I don't either.
One more little Amtrak thing is that currently there is a sale on sleepers. You can buy one, get one sleeper car tickets. So, if you're going to go across country on Amtrak and you've got a friend to do it with, now is the time to buy. I was going to say, they do this fairly commonly. It seems like at least once a year you get one of these sales that come up. And this is really where Amtrak makes a lot of money, which is ironic, considering these are on trains that, wouldn't it be so great if they cut them? So says the Amtrak executive. I mean, Delta executive.
What is that?
I mean, Amtrak executive.
Dick Anderson.
Yeah.
But anyway, speaking of wider, well, you still can. The Hoop Trolley in St. Louis, for those that don't know, it's probably less than a mile. It's about a mile long, give or take a few blocks, whatever. And they operate they could be operating four cars, but they aren't. Because their Melbourne cars are still getting upgraded for their system. Which they have two of them that they got from Seattle. And then they have two replica Council Crest cars. I wonder where they got
those. Which ones are the ones that they crashed?
I believe the Council Crest car.
Nice.
Or one of them. I believe it may have been their 002.
They're super old school trolleys with pantographs on them, and it looks weird.
Old, I
know they're replicas,
style.
But...
Yeah. That's PCC trucks under them. Which is a whole different tangent entirely. But anyways, it could fold in November, and that's St. Louis County gives it $700,000.
They are $700,000 in debt. How did that happen?
Congrats, you idiots. Now you can maybe give us our cars back.
Apparently they never even got it off the ground. They started building it and then just ran out of money. I mean, I've heard
They've been doing test runs, but that's been about it. They haven't hauled a single fucking passenger. Sorry, pardon my friend. But they haven't done shit.
Well.
And it makes me mad.
They should be building faster. Fast, like the MTA. Fast, like the Long Island Railroad, replacing a bridge in just 55 hours. An entire bridge.
Wow.
That is less than 3 days. So, early morning, Monday, October 7th, 2019, workers completed the replacement of a 108-year-old bridge over Nassau Boulevard in Garden City with a higher bridge that will reduce truck accidents. Oh boy. Somehow it will also improve on-time performance with the magical powers imbued in the bridge. and it will also carry a third bay? It's called a track, guys. A third track for expanding the railroad. Fifth major bridge to be completed in the past 17 weeks, so that's also super impressive.
That's cool.
And they're going to be replacing four more bridges and six more... They're going to replace four more bridges and also bridge six other roads. So there are six grade crossings that they're going to eliminate. within the next 35 months, so about a year and a half. No, sorry, about 3 years. Derp. So, that's, yeah. The new bridge replaces a bridge dating to 1911, the third year of President William H. Taft's administration. That was just 11 foot 6 above the roadway. So it kept getting hit by trucks, so they made a 14 foot bridge, and they replaced the whole thing. Which, I mean, just goddamn, that's impressive. New York does not have the necessarily pedigree of fast infrastructure projects, but that is impressive.
Wait, they replaced the bridge that kept getting hit all the time?
They replaced one, not the one. It wasn't 11 foot 8. It was just another bridge that was also short. For another infrastructure project in New York City, we can talk about the Rockaway Beach Branch, which is a abandoned rail line. It's dormant. It still exists. But
yeah.
It's in Brooklyn and Queens, I believe. Long dormant rail link between Rockaway Beach and the rest of Queens is getting a new look. So, this is super important. I brought this up before, but the New York City subway system and transit system is very Manhattan-centric. And, like, half of the development has been in the outer boroughs, which is a lot compared to in previous years. So, in order to get from Brooklyn to Queens to the Bronx on a subway train, you usually have to go through Manhattan, which is not effective in terms of time. And also it means you get jam-packed in like sardines halfway through your commute. So, opening better north-south links is super important. We've got another article that talks about the same thing, but this is another option. This is the, what's called Queens Rail. And they call it the Queen Link. So, it'll dramatically reduce commute time for people living in what they call a transit desert. Because in that area of Queens, there really isn't much. And the debate has been between the Queensrail people and the Queensway people. The Queensway people want to turn it into a greenway.
Oh, no.
But, yeah. But the issue is, if it were Brooklyn or the Bronx, I would understand a lot more. But Queens is pretty park rich. They've got a lot of green space, relatively speaking, for New York City. They don't have a lot of transit. They need this. And it would enable the MTA to reorganize that part of the system a little bit and just make life better. You know, there are certain parts of the system that are completely underserved. And this would help a lot. So, there is no funding for it in the current capital plan for the next 5 years, but who knows, it might take them 5 years to figure out just what they want to do with it. But
yeah.
But
you know what? Oh, sorry.
They are doing a feasibility study. Then they need to do an environmental review, but that's another $20 or $30 million, and that needs to be budgeted for somewhere, somehow. Without that, it's going to just stagnate. So hopefully this can garner more traction. I mean, I don't have too many people to talk about it in the New York City area, but hopefully they're doing their part to get the word out just as we are.
Yep.
What did you say? I need to come back to you.
And not taking 5 years. CP's Heritage Unit was out and about on their business train.
Oh, it's so good. It's so pretty.
Oh, yeah. Which I'm very glad to see that that worked out for them. Speaking of things working out, the Portland Sioux Railway that we have discussed on multiple occasions, it's now, well, the nomination for a historic site has gone through with the state. The state unanimously voted for it.
Oh, wow.
In favor of it, so.
Yep. That's pretty impressive. That's a lot of support for a Sioux Railway.
Yeah. So now they gotta go national, which could take a few months, but it's more hoops for Metro to jump through with the darn trail that they want to put in there. Yeah.
In the zoo. Zoo trail.
Yeah. It's stupid. But, and the railroad
doesn't even end at the zoo. It went to the road drawings at one point.
Well, they should rebuild
which
it.
Is what they want to do. This is what the group wants to do, but Metro, who had operated the Sioux Railway and still does, wants a trail.
Oh.
You know, because you can't fit a trail with the railroad as it is. No.
Oh, man. There's a... there was a whole thing. The people that I talked about up... at the Rhode Island Transit thing, there is a tiny, tiny stretch of would-be railroad that clips the town of Tiverton, which is way on the west side, or sorry, the east side of the state. It's the connection between Fall River and Newport. Of course, there's a bridge missing. But the right-of-way there is like 80 feet wide. And there are people in the, in RIPTA and in the state transit planning, boards and stuff like that, that just basically are fighting tooth and nail with Tiverton to keep them from paving the whole thing, because you want to have that connection available to Newport if ever you would need it again. And they're big, the guy I talked to, he just seemed kind of exasperated. It's like the right-of-way's 80 feet wide. They can't fit a trail and leave space for the railroad tracks. That's just what we're trying to get them to do. I want to step back to New York City for a second, because this is something that I glance again, one of these articles that I glance at the headline, I developed an opinion, and then I opened it up and read it, and my view of the situation changed a little bit, because it was Bronx man fired from the MTA continued to collect $250,000 in paychecks. And I thought, well, that little sneak, whatever.
Yeah.
But here's the thing. He didn't know he was fired.
Oh.
For the last 6 years, he's been going to work at a job he's been fired from.
What the?
And collecting paychecks.
At that point, does it even...
A Bronx... So here's the whole story. I'll take a question in a second. Ronald Berry, 47, he was on sick leave, claims he's been on sick leave since 2015 for high pressure and asthma. Traveled to a city transit office in Westchester every 2 weeks to sign and pick up his dough. Okay, so he was fired in 2013. He went on sick leave in 2015.
Uh-huh.
And he's just been collecting checks since then. When Barry showed up Thursday to flash his ID badge and grab his pay, he was nabbed for trespassing.
Ooh.
Quote,
okay.
Quote, I never got a call that I was terminated. Unquote. Stunned, Barry said, told the Post outside his Bronx home on Saturday, quote, I've been collecting paychecks for 4 effing years. When a Post reporter told Barry he was dismissed way back in 2013, he countered, so how am I still collecting checks? That's also what he asked his boss after the arrest. His boss replied, that's not my problem, that's payroll's problem.
Okay.
So
I mean, if you get fired in 2013 and then work for another 2 years and manage to not get fired again in those 2 years, does it really count?
Yeah.
Like at that point, do they not just go, oh, wait, you were supposed to be fired, but you're not doing anything wrong, so carry on.
It's just, oh, my God.
It would just be something weird, that's for sure.
That's brilliant.
And here's another amazing another amazing communication breakdown. So 4014. What has 4014 been doing lately?
Breaking things.
Not quite.
Touring the entire United States, at least the areas Union Pacific has tracked for.
Specifically the Southwest. They've been doing their great race across the Southwest. And
yeah.
Allegedly, many law enforcement officials were, quote, largely unaware of Union Pacific Big Boy's pending arrival. And there's another quote down here. What steam locomotive?
That's pure. That's just poppycock.
I've seen this one before.
Quote, what steam locomotive? That was the initial response when trains contacted numerous law enforcement agencies in Arizona, Texas, Arkansas, Oklahoma, and Kansas. The world's largest operating steam locomotive is not commanding in the same level of law of law enforcement's attention as it did when it debuted in Wyoming and Utah in May. So, oh my god.
I still find that to be poppycock, to be honest.
I mean, if you're not a foamer, you might not notice that. I feel like, yeah, it's the municipality's fault for not noticing or for not paying attention to the news that something very large is coming to your town. But also, don't you think the Union Pacific would want to tell them? Yeah. Don't you think they would just take a minute to ring up these guys and go, hey, you might have a huge roving pack of foamers coming through your town, and you're going to want to get some extra troops out there, or extra troopers out there, because they're going to do dumb stuff like cause a six-vehicle collision on a frontage road.
They're going to have to be careful.
Yeah, holy cow.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Careful.
This is...
Has Peters in Utah flashbacks.
Oh my god. So... yeah, amazing. And it goes hand in hand with the six-car accident that we reported on last time. And also, there's an alternate angle of it, and you can see it's like an old Ford that got beat up. It was the antique car that got hit. So
that's a girl, my lord, in a flatbed Ford.
So, yeah. Anyway,
oh, cool. Well, speaking of people getting beat up, this is a terrible segue that I'm going to go for. Sounder hit someone.
Are they okay?
Jesus.
Pedestrian, critical condition.
Ooh.
That sounds bad.
Also, I just noticed we don't have any Brightline murders this time around.
Holy crap. That's like
strange. It's quiet. That's quiet.
Brightline keeps showing up and collecting its paychecks, so...
Yeah.
I think that's the first podcast in a while where there hasn't been Brightline.
In quite a while.
The female bedroom was struck around 6:40 p.m.
Gosh, I think it was last podcast I said every podcast Brightline does something.
You did it. You saved it.
Well, anyway, she's been taken to hospital, so... Yeah.
I hope so. They didn't just leave her there?
Oof.
No, but they may have done that with a tram down in Australia.
Is this one that entered somebody's lawn?
Yep.
What?
They had a hell of a derailment. You can see you can see the picture in here.
Tram attack.
Yep.
Oh my god.
Tram attack?
It took what you might call a hard left.
Yeah. It's like that one episode of Thomas.
How did it do that?
It's that one episode. It's like a what episode, Thomas? Yeah.
The one where it comes through Thomas comes to breakfast.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that one.
Eat cornflakes!
Cornflakes, you cocksucker!
That's like when you've gone through our breakfast. Yes, now I have to get the mark.
Seven people were taken to the hospital.
Good lord.
Seven
people. Do you have a good segue, TBA?
No.
Okay. So, this has nothing to do with the podcast, but I thought it was not amusing. That's a little bit morbid. Mines had their homecoming parade yesterday.
Yeah.
They high-centered the trailer hitch for one of the floats.
Oh, boy.
It collapsed, and 10 people went to the hospital.
Oh, my God.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, if we want to talk about sending people to the hospital. So, there was a derailment on the Red Line in Boston. A pretty dramatic one, as a matter of fact, that we talked about previously. And what happened is, you've got a Red Line train coming into the station, and on the second car, one of the axles just snaps. And that second car then jumps up onto the platform and demolishes a signal cabinet. And basically crippled that entire station, which is the only major junction on the Red Line. So, that sucked.
Great.
And I actually talked to somebody who knew a lot about this, the person I happened to sit next to in Boston. And one of the brushes that contacts the...
Not that
contacts the third rail, but actually that contacts the axle to return the current back to ground.
Ah.
Apparently, it had become worn down, and then it was, like, arcing. It was arcing and cutting away at the axle, and eventually it just basically cut all the way through this axle, which then snapped.
So they essentially plasma cut the axle
exactly,
in half.
Just very slowly. And they had to sideline... You know, they had to then sideline, like, every car, every single car, you know, not all at the same time, but then, you know, open them up and make sure that this wasn't happening. It wasn't happening on any other car. It was just this fluke incident where this thing started going nuts.
That happened. All
right.
Yeah. But for those on your morning commute, particularly in the New York area, fear not, or New Jersey area, I guess, fear not, because the Portal Bridge, which we've talked about, which I've talked about several times before, which is a swing bridge on the Northeast Corridor, will never open again. During rush hour, anyway. So, the Coast Guard is permanently banning opening the bridge during morning and evening commuter rush. Because it keeps getting stuck, and it keeps just backing up the whole Northeast Corridor, because it takes them hours to get it to close again.
Close to
500 trains a day cross this bridge. So
the Coast Guard is forbidding boats from going through it rush hour?
Yeah, basically the Coast Guard has stepped in and said, we're going to do our part to make sure that nothing goes wrong with this, and we're going to bar people, you know, large ships anyway, from going through here during rush hour. Because it's creating hell. Because then when the drawbridge is stuck open, then you have to get, like, a boat out there, because you basically have created an island. You have to get a boat out there with maintenance people, etc. Also, by the way, during rush hour, that's about a train every 2 minutes when the line is operating. So talk about, TBA, you wouldn't worry about missing anything. If you were rail fanning, is what I'm saying. This is one of the things that would be replaced with the Gateway Project, if we want to soapbox about that a little bit more. But anyway, Portal Bridge needs work, but this is a Band-Aid. It will keep things from getting too out of hand, but I'm sort of concerned that the fewer openings means that now it'll just break during the other times instead.
It's fine.
Whatever, it's fine. you know what isn't fine in New Jersey? Parking too close to the tracks.
Oh, no.
So there was a car and a truck that had parked past a barrier along the railroad tracks in Port Jervis, and they were doing the 27th Annual Fall Foliage Festival, and the train hit those cars. Because they were parked too close to the track. In fact, took the bumper clean off of one of them.
Oh.
And I don't know, I can't see the other one, but that's... Oh my god. But you know, the people attending said they loved the festival, and the vendors were happy and everything, just not those people. Parking is a huge issue, they say, but fortunately nobody was hurt. also, Maria Mann, Tourism Board Vice Chairwoman and the owner of the Gun Lady Store, noted that as the city continues to grow, parking is a growing issue. While no one should have been parked where these vehicles were located, Mann stresses the need for the tracks to be moved back. Or you could just have parking somewhere else.
Yeah,
I feel like one of those two is easier. I feel like moving the tracks is not something that's not the easy solution
here.
Just have people park somewhere else.
That's not the practical solution.
Uh-uh. What would that be?
The practical solution would be make more parking. Or
no parking.
Park elsewhere.
Yeah, park elsewhere. Have some shuttles in. Hell, use the train. You've got one.
Yeah.
All right.
Oh, what else do we have to talk about?
How are we doing time-wise?
Pretty good.
Okay.
Very good, I would say.
So the high-speed train from Las Vegas to Los Angeles, they have their sights set on starting in 2023.
Vegas, okay. Baby!
I'm not, you know, I think it might actually, I think it'd be cool, because there's not really much, you know, there's not really a rail train, can't really take a train to Vegas, I don't think.
No, you can't.
No, not anymore.
This is an easier way for, you know, lower security drunks to get from Vegas to LA.
Exactly.
Which should be profitable.
Not only should it be profitable, but keep plenty of drunk drivers off the road.
Yeah.
Yes.
And, I mean, if you can buy the tickets ahead of time, that saves you the issue of not having the money for gas after you've blown it all in Vegas.
Yeah.
True.
I mean, yeah, but you have that with an airline, too.
I think it would be really cool, and... Yeah, I hope they would expand it more than just Las Vegas and Los Angeles.
Well, there's just the same people that now own Brightline, so yeah. I'm sure they're going to.
I'm sure they have aspirations, but this is what they want to do. I applaud this effort, and I think it is a really, really great opportunity.
Oh, like, yeah, I think
Vegas,
there's
baby.
There's plenty of room out there to do it. That'll be cool.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You know what else is cool?
Work on it. That'd be cool.
Alaska Railroad Pit 557.
Oh, is that the... Okay. I glanced at this and I was like, I don't know whose engine this is.
Just on 60.
Yeah. It's the only Alaska Railroad engine being fixed up currently. Mm-hmm. Citation needed.
Citation needed.
Besides, you know, the rest of their engines.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's exciting. I like to hear about them. What are they doing?
They're in the massive reassembly phase. Basically just putting stuff back on.
Steamtown did something like that. They just posted a picture like, check out the firebox. They just got the firebox of 3713 delivered.
Oh yeah, is that
cool?
Yeah. It's huge. I mean, you know, we went in there when we saw them, they were like trying to patch it. I guess they just gave up with that. They were like, we'll just get a new one. This is Steve Todd, just like, it's not worth the effort, we can just pay some money, get a brand new firebox, attach the barrel to it, call it a day.
And be done.
Yeah. I mean...
They got a new, like, wrapper and outer firebox, too?
Yeah. Like...
Wow.
It's just... I would need to pull up the picture again, it just looks like brand new firebox. Just poof. Whole thing.
Wow.
Right. Well, speaking of people getting nice things, the Monticello Railroad Museum in Monticello, Illinois is...
Monticello?
Isn't it Monticello?
Yeah, they're getting...
I don't know, is it? Monticello?
Yeah.
Okay.
But anyway, they're getting a turntable from the... And they're going to restore it.
Where are they getting it from?
Pomona City Park?
Oh, okay.
Something like that, waterfront park.
Is it just anyway, like, yeah, oh, you know, I just pulled up the article. Yeah, it's just sitting there. It's just a turntable in the middle of the park.
All right.
They used to extend to have a new life, and the city's wondering what to do with, or what to do with the site after the turntable's gone.
Put a sign. There was once a turntable here.
Where is the turntable going? Do we know?
Monticello Railway Museum. They won the steam tube.
Cool. So it's not going very far.
No. It's not going very far, and it's going to be used again. Yeah.
It's a neat engine.
Yeah.
I've never seen this engine before.
Interesting.
Museum.
If we're going to talk about... Oh, sorry. You can go ahead, but I'll come back to the roundhouses and turntables.
Whoops.
Okay, well... Sorry, I was going to go off and neat little entrance here. 61 has gotten more work done on her. She's gotten replacement spring hangers and spring saddles.
Mm-hmm.
And new builder's brakes and a new number plate.
It is really nice to hear about the progress of these engines week over week over week. It's nice to know that stuff is being worked on like that. 1361 is currently showing off their tender. Which means they're almost done, as we know.
Yep.
Yep. But yeah, they're about to, the folks at the Altoona Museum are about to reach another milestone because they, the tender is basically done and is going to be painted next month.
Neat.
So it's on display. The trucks are, the trucks have got roller bearings. The scoop is operational. Not that they're going to need it or use
cool.
it.
Cool. I was going to say why, but cool.
I mean, why not?
Yeah, very cool.
So, I mean, it's cool to see that they're finally making tangible progress as well. It's nice to see them and 3713 sort of coming out of the woodwork with, like, hey, oh, no, yeah. We are doing things. We are working. We, yeah. We're not just sitting
here. We do exist. I'm not dead yet.
I'm not dead yet. But you know what else still exists?
Alive.
This is something
I Team Roundhouse with their BNLE tender.
Oh, yeah.
Off got a big 643. Tender. Yeah.
For the king.
Where is that?
I posted it here.
Oh, okay.
Because I don't think we had
it. We not have a... Oh, no, we didn't have a link. We had a picture. That's why.
Yeah. How are they going to move that engine?
Very carefully.
Yeah. But good to see stuff happening.
Yeah.
Anyway, those...
I mean, they really swept in there. This is something I didn't know existed. There is a surviving roundhouse from the Old Colony Railroad. Which was
Old
a division,
railroad?
Yeah,
that?
Which was yeah. a division of the New York, New Haven, and Hartford. It was one of the first rail lines in Boston, and indeed one of the oldest, sort of, I guess you could call it, conglomerate rail lines in the country. Mm. It also has the distinct honor, if you could call it that, of while the New Haven was bankrupt, going bankrupt. So they had the New Haven Railroad leased the Old Colony and all of its lines for 99 years. The Old Colony said, okay, you know, basically we're handing everything over to you, we're owned by you now, we exist only as a series of management positions, basically. There are no,
right.
you know, there are no Old Colony, at that point there were no Old Colony engines or anything like that after the merger was complete, or after the lease, I guess.
Okay.
The New Haven is in the throes of bankruptcy, and they say, sorry, Old Colony, you're costing us money, you can go it on your own again. And the Old Colony goes, uh-huh, with what? And they start a lawsuit, and eventually it was determined that, no, you can't just do that. But there is a surviving roundhouse from the Old Colony as it exists in Hyannis, which is out on the Cape. And it's in danger of being demolished, and it's indeed the last roundhouse on the Old Colony. And I think it might be the last roundhouse from the New Haven. I don't know of any other survivors. So, hopefully...
Huh.
They want to turn it into a parking lot, of course.
Paper.
But they... You know, there are groups that are trying to preserve the roundhouse. It doesn't have a turntable or anything. It looks like it was sort of garages or whatever. Oh, you know what? It was used for the... It was used by, like, the DOT for storage. But yeah,
it's always disappointing to see something like this. You know, they want to tear down the roundhouse and turn it into apartments or something. It's almost insulting when they want to turn it into a parking lot, though.
Yeah,
just because it's like you are taking something that has so much, you know, it's this rich history, it's this cool building that you could use for something, and you're going to turn it into what is arguably the most useless, wasteful pieces of infrastructure that exists.
Yeah. Yep.
We're literally going to pave a field so cars can sit here.
And do Great. Nothing.
And yeah. do yeah. nothing.
So...
Well, hopefully that gets saved.
Yeah, I really do hope so, because it is a particularly historic building, if it is what it is. Also, wait a minute, yeah. We have this. This is the 643 update. Who had this? Oh, Jader had this from last
week. Jader took it.
Okay. Hold on, let me take that. He never got to it, so...
That's interesting.
But that was in the tender update.
No, it wasn't, but it was just another update with the same engine. Okay.
We're so close.
Sorry, I had to steal that. Sorry, Jader. Bye. He's not gonna watch this.
No.
There's another group that's trying to save a railroad tower before it gets demolished. This is in Kalamazoo, Michigan. This was a BO tower near Porter Street in Kalamazoo, originally built in 1888 and reconstructed after a fire in 1914. It's even got old levers in it. So, yeah, the tracks are run remotely from Chicago. The tower sits too close to the track, but officials are open to allowing a group to move it. Otherwise, it's going to be demolished because it's too close to the track. Which is a shame. Unfortunately, if it's not out of the way by early next year, it's probably going to be demolished.
That's a bummer.
That's unfortunate.
Yeah. It's in rough shape, least... I gotta say.
Yeah, at least...
You know.
At least you can save some of the gubbins. Yeah. You know, you could get what's left of the interlocking machine and some of the levers out of it.
That would be the best part, honestly. The structure itself is neat, but if they got in there and they just took the levers out and the actual interlocking mechanisms, that would be by far the best part.
And it looks like the structure, although it is cool, it just has a simple shingled roof. It's made out of cinder blocks, and it has just a wooden... You know, it's not this beautiful... ornate, like, brick structure with wood inlay. You know, it's kind of...
Yeah.
It's very generic looking.
Yeah. I mean, it's neat, but so are a lot of things.
Yeah.
What's not going to be neat anymore...
I'd rather see that roundhouse saved than that, honestly.
What's not going to be neat anymore is the Huron Central, because GNW is closing it. Despite working with both the provincial government of Ontario and the federal government in Canada to find a workable solution over the past few years, a resolution was not found. Freight volumes in the line were insufficient to maintain a commercial operation without support, and GNW has decided to cease service on the line. So, that's a shame.
Wow.
Maybe somebody else will buy it, but... I mean, it's almost unusual you see GNW shut something down.
I wonder if they're looking at Iowa Pacific and kind of going,
we don't want to end up like those.
Seeing
guys.
The ghost of Christmas future.
Yeah.
I'm the ghost of Christmas future.
Speaking of Christmas future, the Reading and Northern is doing a Santa train. I wonder if they'll pay taxes on it. Anyway.
Tax man.
Apparently.
Ho, ho, ho! Over my dead body, you bureaucratic fucks!
Yes.
But you know, at least GNW gave 30 days warning before laying everybody off and shuttering the railroad, whereas Union Pacific gave 2.
True.
200 Union Pacific workers were laid off at Neff Yard in Kansas City with exactly 2 days' notice.
God.
So, yeah.
I mean, I suppose that's better than being approached and being told to go home. But, yikes.
Not by much.
Yeah, but when you leave a job, you're supposed to give 2 weeks' notice. They could have at least done the same to say that they're closing the yard and eliminating your position. Jesus Christ.
Well, and you know it's... With something like Union Pacific, this happened at least a quarter ago, the decision to do this.
Yeah.
Like, the decisions don't happen quickly and out of the blue on Union Pacific. These things take time, and they could have given the 2 weeks fairly easily.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, I will cut into Eric's territory here, just so that we can get all this stuff out of the way. Speaking of decisions from the higher-ups, the East Japan Railway has now eliminated the gender difference between the uniforms in the for their train attendants. So they have abolished shirts, they've abolished ribbons. Now everybody wears a jacket, shirt, tie, pants. Everybody.
Interesting.
So,
all right.
I think that's good. I mean, I think that's a step in a very good direction. I mean, I would like it to just be uniform in general. It's sort of... I mean, it seems unfortunate that they had to eliminate things, but on the other hand...
On the other hand, what?
Well, if they wanted to make things completely uniform, but they didn't want to eliminate the ability for women to have skirts, the resultant would be... given the ability for men to wear skirts?
Mm.
And I mean, this isn't Scotland, so...
Scotland!
What the heck that noise is?
Unpleasant.
Unpleasant is right.
My utterly crappy attempt at bagpipe music.
Yes, good job.
You're right.
Ooh. But no good deed goes unpunished. Because 10 trains 10 Shinkansen trains, as a matter of fact, worth a combined total of 32.8 billion yen. I don't know what that is in Freedom units, but it's a lot of money.
Not that much. Not that much. Or not that many, sorry.
Still,
32 billion?
32.8 billion yen. Japanese yen.
Is 302 million.
That's it? For 10 Shinkansen?
Yes.
Damn.
Apparently.
Anyway.
The yen is not very strong.
The bullet train yard in the city of Nagano was flooded due to heavy rain. And that's 10 trains, 120 carriages, a third of the trains on the line sunk.
Ugh.
Yikes. Vital functions such as brakes, transformers, and air conditioning control systems are installed underneath the carriages and the train. They are all underwater.
Ouch.
So,
stick them in rice.
Man.
Yikes.
Because apparently you can just stick people with sushi, it turns out.
No, it'll dry them out. Or,
what?
Depending on your point of view, it'll either dry them out or it will attract Asians who will fix your electronics for you.
Jesus Christ!
Well, there's Asian singles in my area, apparently. So.
You're right.
You know, there's also a lot of Asians that they don't need to attract them to? Japan!
Well, yeah, but, you know, I'm saying, you know, if you drop your phone in water, it's sort of like putting the tooth under your pillow.
God!
The tech fairy.
You need new transistor! Five-para!
There is an article here about improvements to the MBTA in terms of doing things like electrification, but the one thing I want to pull out of this, which stunned me...
Guys, I gotta go to bed, so see ya.
Alright, sayonara.
Sorry, I couldn't stick for the entire episode.
That's okay, if you want to write a termination down below, we'll talk about it, or we'll say it when you're logging off.
He's gone.
So, they're saying on the... This is mainly about the Framingham-Worcester line, which is the line that goes west out of Boston. And it says that the curves on the Worcester line currently have weak levels of banking, which I think is just mean to the curves. Just calling them weak.
Weak!
But
there's no super elevation. Two even left. Weak, dog.
It's weak.
Weak. Weak sauce.
So something's wrong with Dean's stream. They want electric trains, but here's the thing. Here's the thing that stunned me. Since 2012, ridership on the line has grown 45%. Which, at a glance, might not seem like a lot, but that's a lot of people. That's a lot more people.
Yeah.
You know, for you to have 1.5 times as many people as you started with.
Yeah, that's
especially
good.
On this, which, I mean, it runs to Worcester, but not too many people would make that commute before.
Yeah.
So, they also advocate for scrapping the South Station expansion, which I don't like, because we need more bays at South Station anyway. Yeah. I agree with most of what they're saying. I don't agree with some of what they're saying. I just think the MBTA needs some help and some money. Okay. One more thing before I get to the really sad thing, which apparently was developing, but I don't know if we got anything else. This is what we might have all seen coming. There is now a court battle going on about train crew size.
About what?
Train crew size.
Oh, train crew, yes.
Yep. So, as we discussed previously, what?
Haven't most states already said, no, you cannot have a one-person crew in this state?
A handful of states have said that. 8 U.S. freight railroads have filed a lawsuit against a railroad union, saying the union is refusing to come to the bargaining table to hash out issues involving train crew size.
I have their calendar on my wall.
So, apparently they want to come to the table. The unions obviously don't want to come to the table because they don't want crew size reduced any. the railroads want to discuss it, and by discuss it, they mean tell the unions force why it. They're wrong and then do what they want.
You know, as companies do with unions.
So, the railroads disagree. Okay, so, SMART-TD is consistent, refused to bargain over crew consist, asserting, among many other things, that any proposals on this subject are barred by moratorium provisions in the existing agreements. The railroads disagree with that interpretation and maintain that any disagreement over the meaning of moratoriums is a minor dispute subject to binding arbitration. So basically the unions are saying, hey, there's already legislation in place that says we can't talk about this, and the railroads are saying, no, there isn't. So the lawsuit defines the moratorium provisions as protections offered to employees in exchange for reductions in crew consist. The railroads say these moratoriums don't prohibit the railroads from making new proposals on other subjects, including the number, function, or assignment of ground service personnel on trains. This is real legal.
Yeah.
So
this is something that it's worth pointing out. The railroads have wanted to do since the 70s.
Yeah.
This isn't a new idea.
No.
Or a new issue.
It's getting more and more palatable, but yes. It's not a new issue.
Yes.
Okay, instead of saying, all right, TBA, you do your thing, because I am going to do one more article and then make an incredibly distasteful segue into our final piece of news.
Oh, no.
So, this is something that I honestly, you don't see happening very much anymore in modern day railroading, but CN is actually purchasing track from CSX.
Now, not just like a little bit of track, like a lot of track.
Not just like 200 miles of track.
Yeah.
Wow. In
New York State.
Yeah.
Which is...
Alright.
That's kind of crazy. But they're buying track between Montreal and Syracuse.
Syracuse? Yeah. So, yeah, they're trying to make inroads, I guess. Or one inroad in particular. I would like to see a map of this, because I don't exactly understand what they're talking about.
Does that mean that CSX is starting to go under?
No.
Yeah.
If anything, I mean, CSX is probably going to make bank off of this. CSX is doing fine in that area, and they've been trying to get rid of some of these lines they don't use very much. For example, the entire BNA, a huge section in Florida, which I do believe they managed to sell off recently, and a handful of other lines. They're slimming down, but I wouldn't say it's because they're going out. In fact, if I were to look at them compared to Union Pacific, I would say that Union Pacific is in a lot worse position in terms of feeling the burn from PSR than CSX is.
Yeah.
CSX was already in kind of a good position to conduct PSR in terms of the fact, or, you know, with respect to the fact that they had fewer online customers and more like hub and spoke type stuff. Whereas Union Pacific, you know, because we don't have a lot of industry in this area too much anymore. So they had a lot of intermodal traffic and stuff like that, and Union Pacific does too, but Union Pacific ends up losing out customers on branch lines and stuff, which CSX just basically didn't have to lose. Also, Union Pacific is a lot more spread out. They've got a lot more to maintain than CSX does. But, yeah, this is interesting. I want to see how this goes forward, and I want to see, like, how operationally that's going to work.
Now, do you think CSX is gonna... They're currently a Class 1.
Yeah.
What if they... Eventually, are they going to be going down to, like, a Class 2?
I mean, if they lost... Probably not. If they lost that much in the way of mileage and market share, yeah, but I don't think they would. We're gonna see KCS do that first. I mean, KCS... Yeah. Is the reason we don't hear about them much is because they just don't do much. You know, they're hanging on to that Class 1 designation barely.
Barely.
But anyway, well, do you want to talk about your bits of news before I ruin the end of the show?
Yeah, I'll talk about this one. The other one I'll save for another couple weeks because I think it's going to wind up being redundant in time.
Okay.
They just conducted boiler tests on number 60007, Sir Nigel Gresley. It's a sister to the Mallard over in England.
This would be the first A4 running in a while, wouldn't it?
Not in the longest time. You know, they have A4s that have run fairly regularly.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if any have run, like, in the past couple years recently, but yeah, there have been some since at least, like, 2015, 2016.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Yeah. They're not super, super rare sites, but this is one that gets around quite a bit, so it'll be cool to see it back in service.
Oh, okay, neat.
And additionally, I might as well mention it really quick. The Durango and Silverton's getting really close on the 493 restoration. They have painted the tender now. They have lagged the boiler entirely. They've even done the... they're starting to do jacketing in the cab, pardon me. Eventually, they'll paint the locomotive, and right now their biggest setback is that the oil tank they had made for the engine was too small.
Oof.
Whoops.
Oops.
Well.
So, yeah.
Finally, I'll come back around to this. I think I talked about it last episode, but we have a petition to tell Amtrak and Congress we want dining car service to remain on all long-distance trains, which of course we do. But,
yes.
You know, as we talked about, because of budgeting shenanigans, Amtrak doesn't feel like they're making any money off the dining cars, and thus they don't feel the obligation to keep them, even though if you're stuck on a train for several days, you probably want a hot meal. Unfortunately, to Amtrak, it feels like it's costing an arm and a leg, which is exactly what it cost some moron who tried to jump onto the Steam Into History train and ended up getting what you might call traumatically amputated.
Oh, God.
Yeah. A man tried to jump onto the Steam Into History excursion train and lost his left leg when the locomotive ran over him.
Ooh.
Oh.
Also, surprise, he was intoxicated.
I'm shocked.
No.
So, yeah.
Ooh, this is... Ooh.
Yeah, it's, what you might call unfortunate.
The train... I find it curious that the train did not stop and return to the depot.
Oh.
Like, did they not see him?
I don't know.
That's bad news, Barris.
Quote,
we've
not have anything happen like this in the past. Well, yeah, you're steaming a history, not Brightline.
Yeah. I mean, if nothing else, there probably won't be outcry of like, oh, the day, you know, people I think are going to see this as a drunken idiot got himself hit by a train, and hopefully people can move on from there. I feel bad for the crew.
I feel bad for the crew. I mean, I feel bad for the guy as well.
Yeah. But, I feel bad for the guy, but it, you know, he brought it on himself.
He brought it on himself. He was hammered.
The crew. Yeah. Well, that's what I'm saying. It's like, yeah, I feel bad for the guy because he lost half of his leg, which sucks. But at the same time, the crew is innocent here. They ran a guy over, and I can't imagine what they're going through and the guilt they're feeling. At least they didn't kill him.
Imagine
whereas this
effing,
guy, it's his fault.
Imagine effing being blackout drunk and waking up and not having a leg. And just not knowing what happened in between being at the bar with both your legs and being in the hospital with one of them. Like,
yeah. And then being told that the reason you have half of your left leg missing is because you tried to stow away on...
You tried to jump onto a moving train.
Yes.
Yikes.
That guy's nuts.
Well...
Do we know how fast the train was going?
Not very fast.
No. Float slow.
Yeah.
Well, he still missed, didn't he?
Yeah. I mean, if he's trying to get on at the front.
Oh.
Again, I'm surprised that they didn't... It says in the article, apparently the train didn't stop and return to the station. Did they not see him?
I guess not. Now I'm questioning what time of day was this?
It was in the evening, apparently.
Because I was going to say, this guy is, like, day drinking. Something. You know?
The train was just pulling out from the Glenrock Mill Inn and would have been moving, quote, very...
Yikes. Yeah. You broke up. But, yeah. 9:05 p.m. Returning to its depot in New Freedom.
So maybe it was dark.
I guess. It must have been. I mean, 9 o'clock, it was definitely dark. Anyway. Alright, let's play our favorite game, then, if we've got nothing else that we want to talk about.
No, I've got something I want to talk about.
Oh, no, what do you want to talk about?
Union Pacific is out of their mind.
Yeah, we know.
How do they have the audacity to complain about crew shortages when they fire their crews and refuse to hire more crews?
I mean,
what are they doing? Oh, Julius was talking about how they have, like, three or more trains.
He later came back and said that was because of derailment. They were stuck there.
I didn't see that.
Yeah. I just happened to notice it, and I was like, well, that makes more sense. It was just, he just mentioned it as an aside. But still, I mean, it's still true, though.
Still, they still do that. It's still a true thing that happens, you know. We need crews. We have no one to drive our trains. It's because you guys don't hire any people.
And also, nobody wants to work your crappy hours.
That's the weirdest thing, TBA. They are hiring. They're also firing.
Yeah. They're firing faster than they're hiring.
It's not even, you know, they're belly aching about the crew shortages. They're hiring like mad. They're desperate for people. And yet every week we seem to go through something about how they've laid off another few hundred guys somewhere.
And it's mostly yard guys that they're laying off, but still.
Yeah. There seems like there'd be a smarter solution here.
Maybe stop firing people.
I wonder. Whoa. You're talking like that. They'll never put you in charge.
No.
Yeah. You'd be a lousy politician, TBA. You're making way too much sense.
What?
Hey, wait a minute.
Anyway, latest train on Amtrak.
We've got some late ones today, but one later than them all by a lot. So,
oh no.
Also, one extra here. What is going on with you? Anyway, what do you guys think is the latest train on Amtrak?
I'm gonna have to go with that extra that you mentioned, just for the sake of seeing what's up.
It doesn't seem like anything's out of the ordinary, but something got a service disruption and is now running under a different number. I don't know why.
Interesting.
Alright.
Milky, TBA.
Westbound Sunset.
Westbound Sunset. Alright, you do have a Westbound Sunset. It is late.
One of the northbound Starlights? That one's usually late.
Northbound Starlight. Okay. Which one is
good.
The northbound? Northbound's 14. Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Well, are you sure you want to go with the extra?
Sure, why not?
Okay. Well, the extra is a silver star running under the number 1192 instead of 92. I'm not sure why. Again, some sort of service disruption seems to have occurred. And they are still on the line. They're running about half an hour late.
Oh.
So.
Damn.
Yeah. I mean, not terrible, but...
Not great.
Not great, but just kind of weird. The Sunset Limited, the westbound Sunset Limited is an hour and 48 minutes late. It's about halfway through Arizona, heading towards Maricopa right now. It's actually just about to arrive in Tucson. So, there's that. Not the latest train on Amtrak. Still pretty late, but not as late as a lot of the other long-distance trains, including the latest of the late, the Coast Starlight. Northbound.
Oh, damn it.
Yep. At 7 hours and 23 minutes late in Eugene
right
now. Oh, no.
Yikes.
The other
Which
Coast
Starlight... Which one did you do, Milky? The north or the south?
I decided to not do the Coast Starlight.
You always...
I'm like, okay, I think they've been doing fine recently, but no.
Now, well, you know what I would have picked, not knowing anything? Looking at the derailment, I probably would have gone with the chief, because they still might have been recovering from that derailment.
I don't know. So, you know, sometimes the coast, like the Starlight, just gets late.
Okay, here's what happened. Something happened between Oakland and Emeryville. What, I don't know, but it picked up 7.5 hours of delay.
Wow.
It was 18 minutes late, and then it was 7 hours and 40 minutes late at
Emeryville. It basically just freaking started.
It just stopped.
Yeah.
It just came to a halt for 7.5 hours. The other Coast Starlight is an hour late, so that's not that bad. We've also got some weird stuff. The Vermonter is 2.5 hours late. The Capital Punishment and the Cardinal are each an hour late. There's a Zephyr and a Chief that are each 2 hours late. There's the other Sunset, which is 2.5 hours late. And nothing super late in Canada. I mean, there's a 5 hour late Skeena, but that's not that weird. And a 4 hour late Hudson Bay. But there's not like a 12 hour late anything, which is kind of a nice change.
Yeah.
But that is the latest train on Amtrak by several hours. It's the latest train in North America. That's a feat.
Yeah.
Anyway. Oh crap, I just rubbed my eye and I salted my finger. Oh, this hurts.
First of the Terminus, Kevon posted something 12 minutes ago, which is actually really interesting.
Well, we'll have to talk about it next time, then. I want to look what it is, but...
It's an interesting article. I'd recommend giving you some time to read it.
Okay. Well, anyway, I decided not to give people points this time, even though plenty of people deserve them. Even myself, especially myself. And first up is Abby, or TBA.
Moving content takes too long. It took me all day just to move most things. I still gotta go through and move the dependencies.
Don't forget your depths. Bears writes, I don't know what to put here, TBH. It's okay, neither do we. I say we're gonna need a bigger decapod.
Kooka dude. Milky.
I found this amazing archive for it online of White Pass 66 running, which is one of their big 10-wheelers.
Cool.
How big is big?
And, not very.
Well,
and I found an amazing archive photo of the PR Rare.
PR Rare. Oh, no.
Yep.
Whoops, I made a mistake. The PR Rare. Alright, what is this? Yes, a very, very archive photo realism.
Rare.
Brings new meaning to shark nose? Wait.
I guess, yeah.
Oh my god, it's so stubby. What a stubby 10-wheeler. Yeah. Anyway, hope you guys enjoyed this episode of the Terminus Podcast. We will see you again in a couple of weeks. Bye-bye.
Bye.